about to begin our Bible class. Before we do, we'll just be singing one hymn. So I'm asking those who are on the outside, please come in. We have a very interesting topic to discuss today. Let us pray. Kind Father, I want to give you thanks again for your mercies and your blessings on us. As we've come together again to study your words, I ask that your presence be with us. Help us to understand what we're going to study and apply it to our life as necessary. In your name we pray. Amen. So our hymn will be Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing, hymn 334.
Come the fount of every blessing, tune my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me ever to adore thee, may I still thy goodness prove. While the hope of endless glory fills my heart with joy and love, here I raise my Ebenezer, either by thy help I've come, and I hope by thy good pleasure safely to arrive at home. Jesus sought me when a stranger, wandering from the fold of God. He to rescue me from danger interposed his precious blood. Oh, to grace, how great a tempter, daily I'm constrained to be. Let thy goodness like a fetter bind me closer still to thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it. Prone to leave the God I love. Take your heart, oh, take and seal it. Seal it for thy courts above.
Happy Sabbath, my brothers and sisters. Indeed, it is always a joy when we can come to share the word of God together. And mark the word share, because I am not here to declare that I know it all or everything, but we will share together, and iron shall sharpen it iron. So I'm going to invite the brothers who are there at the front with another study to come on the inside so we can reason this one subject. And we want to welcome those who are joined online as well. Now, this afternoon, hope we'll have enough time to deal with it as efficiently as possible. We went through a study last week when we looked at the issue of Cain's legacy, and some questions came up, questions which are not necessarily new, where persons continue to question as to if Adam and Eve weren't the only created beings, and who was Cain afraid of, since the Bible only made mention of Adam and Eve on earth in the creation account. And the question always been asked as well, did Cain marry did Cain marry an angel or even a fallen angel? So these are three questions that we are hoping that we can shed some light on. And so at this time, I just invite you, prayer was offered already but prayer is never too much, especially as we dig into the Word of God. Father in heaven, we thank you for everything, for the showers of blessings on the outside. We pray now that you may bless our hearts with your words, and may we understand that your word is trustworthy, and you have revealed unto us enough information which is pivotal to the saving of our souls. So may you bless us, may you guide us, and may you protect us. Thank you now as we participate. Open up our minds and grant us intellect and grant us the ability to think, to reason, to rationalize. And may this discussion be guided by your spirit. For we ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen. And so the program, it will be on the screen so that we can follow. Anybody could just turn on these fans. It's very hot. It's very hot up here. I'm burning up. We have some persons online. We welcome you. And so this week, we look on the topic. What's our topic? You're not with me. You're not with me at all. You're not with me. What's our topic? There's only two I'm seeing many persons in the audience, but I'm only hearing one person's response. And I always tell you, I always remind you that I am a teacher by profession, so I am not accustomed to just standing up in front of a class and not have participation from my students, or I'll pick on them, and I'll do likewise here. So let me ask again. I heard two persons. I heard Sister Barrett, and I heard Sister Campbell. So let me ask again, and it's on your screen. It shifted a little. But our topic is... Could you put up back the first slide again, Brother Smith? Let them see this the topic. The wife of Cain. So we want to look at this, Brother Lo. So we go to our slide now, and let's look at this information. Now, the intent of this study is by no means to put a comma where the Bible writers would have put or left a full stop. Bible is sufficient information, right? Now, it is geared towards declaring that the Bible is indeed trustworthy and our guide to salvation, right? So let's jump into our discussion. Sub-questions, as we mentioned, weren't Adam and Eve the only created ones? Who was Cain afraid of? Did Cain marry an angel? Now let's use our Bible, and if you notice, there are two microphones there. We will utilize them so as to ensure that our online platform, they can hear whatever is being discussed on the floor. So we want to go to two particular texts at this time. One person, take one of those mics on with your Bibles. Genesis 1, verse 26 and 27. And another person will find Genesis 2, verse 7. These are two of our first scriptures. And let's move a little bit speedy so as to maximize on the time. Genesis 1, verse 26 and 27. And Genesis 2. Verse 7. All right, so Sister Dobbs, you can take the other microphone in the meantime. Wonderful. Yes, sister, it's good for you. All right, Sister Campbell, you take the first one, Genesis 1, 26 and 27. Sister Dobbs, you take Genesis 2 and verse 7. Go ahead.
Okay, Genesis 1, 26 and 27. And God said, "Let us make man in our own image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth."
Thank you very much. Sister Dab?
27.
Go ahead.
So God created man in his own image. In the image of God created he him. Male and female created he them.
Thank you. Sister Dobbs, go ahead. Genesis 2 verse 7. Genesis chapter 2 verse 7. Genesis 2 verse 7. It's a different chapter, different verse. Genesis 2 verse 7.
And the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostril the breath of life, and man became a living soul.
Thank you very much, my sisters. So what we are seeing here is two different accounts of the same narrative or the same story. Now, if you look at Genesis chapter 1, verse 26 and 27, and the other verses between that and Genesis 2, verse 7, you would have discovered that the Bible writer ended the creation account in verse 31 of Genesis chapter 1 by declaring, "And behold, everything was very good." And that was what? The sixth day. Completing the creation, excepting the Sabbath, right? So every other thing was created, including man. But then, verse 2 goes on to say, "Thus the heavens and the earth were created, finished, and all the hosts of them." I'm at Genesis chapter 2. "And on the seventh day, God ended his work, which he had made, and he rested on the seventh day from his work, which he had made. And God blessed the seventh day and sanctified it, because that in it he had rested from all his work which God had created and made. These are the generations of the heaven and the earth when they were created, in the day that the Lord had made the heaven and the earth." Now this would have ended the first week, right? You're not with me. This would have ended the first week. It would have been closed. Everything would have been created, including the Sabbath. Now, what you realize now that the Bible writer does is that the Bible writer goes back to pick up on a story that he had made a pause on, because he started to talk about the creation of man in verses 26 to 28 of Genesis chapter 1. He skipped it and went on to something else to speak about every tree I've given you and so forth and so forth, and jumped into chapter 2 where he spoke about the institution of the Sabbath. But now we recognize that he's picking up back the story, so he's going back to Genesis. In other words, he's continuing from Genesis 26, 27 by providing additional information that was not provided in chapter 1, such as that, "And the Lord God formed man from the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul." Now, in chapter 1, we were not told of the elements that made man, and we were not told about the breath of life. But the Bible writer came back to the story. And this is oftentimes the practice of some Bible writers. And the writer here, Moses, he took a poetic approach. The SDA Bible commentary said, where he would have paused on one story, go to another event, and then jump back to the story to provide us with additional information. Let's go to the next slide. Genesis, Brother Shippy, microphone. Microphone, microphone, microphone. Repeat.
Preach a sermon for tomorrow night.
Okay.
Right, and when you come by here, people are here waiting. Then when you went to the pulpit, you would declare your topics.
Uh-huh.
Right? And do your
introduction.
And do your introduction.
Okay.
And when you start out, then you'd use a verse. But you do not continue on the verse. You left off just for the people to fully understand. Then you would go to Roman if you did begin Genesis 1. That's what the writer did.
And then eventually come back
and
to the one.
Eventually go back, all right, to settle the flooring.
All right, very much so. And those of you who are online, you can thank you very much, Sister Campbell. Yes, indeed, the topic is the wife of Cain. So that was the approach the Bible writer took. Genesis 1:28. Now, notice that the command was given prior to the fall. What command am I speaking about? Genesis 1:28, when they were told that they were to be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth. In other words, they were told to procreate, to bring offspring, to bring children, and populate the earth. Because that was God's intent, that the earth would have been a populated place to be inhabited by human beings. However, the first record of reproduction was recorded in Genesis 4, verse 1. So there is no record that there was procreation prior to the fall, even though the instruction or the command was given from before the fall. We are not seeing from the scripture where that happened prior to the fall. Genesis 4, verse 1 was the first place the Bible mentioned that procreation took place. And what did it say? And Adam knew his wife, and she conceived and bare Cain, and said, I have gotten a man from the Lord. So this is clear that Cain was the first person born. Well, I said born. Adam and Eve were created. Cain was born from a womb. Wonderful. Genesis 1:26-28. This provides detail on the decision to make. Just going back a little bit. That in Genesis 1:26-28, some details that were there was the image that man was made in the dominion that was given to them, the creation of male and female, which was singular, the blessings of man and the instruction to be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth. And this brought us to day 6. We mentioned this already, just jumping over it. So here we see the Bible writer going back to the account of the creation of man. Now here's some additional details that are provided. This is jumping us back now to Genesis 2 verse 3. The way that man was made from the dust and the breath of life, and man became a living soul, and so forth. That was just additional detail that was not provided in Genesis chapter 1 verse 26 to 28. Adam and Eve. Genesis 2 verse 9. Somebody read that for me quickly. Genesis 2 verse 19 rather. Quickly, we want to use up the Bible. Sister W, look like you're going to be one of our readers today, so maybe you need to stay near to the microphone. Thank you very much. I love you, sweetie. Right at the microphone, Sister W. No, why you sitting down? Thank you very much. Beautiful, beautiful. Genesis 2 verse 19.
And out of the ground made the Lord God to grow every tree that is pleasant to the sight and good for food. The tree of life also is the midst of the garden, and the tree of knowledge of good and evil.
All right, wonderful. All right, Genesis 2 verse 29. That's what you read a while ago. Verse 19. Was it 19 you read or 9? It's 19. 19.
And out of the ground, Lord God formed every beast of the field and every fowl of the air, and brought them unto Adam to see what.
All right, pause right there. So here we are seeing what the first introduction of the name Adam, right? So this is the first human being that the Bible introduces us to the name. Remember, it was already made in Genesis 1, verse 26 to 28. But no name was attached to the person or the persons. But in chapter 2, verse 19, now, some light is being shed on who was the man that was created, which was Adam. And quickly, when we jump to Genesis 3, verse 20, here we recognize that the name of a woman is brought into place. And I'm going to read this one for the interest of time. And we can read together. Genesis 3 verse 20. I want to hear the Bible. Let's read the Bible together. Genesis 3 verse 20. 1, 2. And Adam called his wife's name Eve. Let's pause right there. Thank you very much, sister. You can rest your leg. Right? So here we are seeing a name being given to the woman. The Bible said that he made he male and female. Now, how many persons do we hear in this scenario? How many? How many? Four. Who are the four? No, boss, we don't reach to Cain and Abel yet. It's Adam and Eve. So we are only hearing about two persons, two individuals. What about those who are online? What are you saying? So Genesis 2, 21 to 23 provides detail about the creation of the woman, which was not provided in Genesis 1, 26, 27, and Genesis 2, verse 7. So what we are seeing again is that the Bible writer didn't give us all the information at once. Or there could be a possibility that the events were not recorded in chronological order. What do we mean by that? That the events were not recorded directly as they happened. So it was recorded somehow different from a regular story where you would have had the plot and the setting and you deal with one thing and you don't go back to it again. That's how we are taught in school. Your first paragraph, Brother Miguel, if you're talking about Sister Lo, you're a teacher as well. If in the first paragraph you're talking about Jack and Jill, you deal with them there. And when you go to a second paragraph, you deal with something else. And at the end of it, you conclude everything. This was not the approach of the Bible writer. The Bible writer dealt with something, skip a little bit, or at least how it was recorded. Deal with something, go to another issue, and then come back. And this is what we are seeing happening here again. But we are still not seeing any mention of any other person besides Adam and Eve. So somewhere, as we mentioned, there may be an issue with chronology, or is just the style of the author to move from one story and then. Thank you very much, Sister Campbell. Oh, you're hardly hearing? Oh, they're saying that they're not hearing so much the persons in the audience. So when you're using the microphone, let's read a little bit louder. All right. Genesis 4, verse 1. Conception occurs after the fall of man. Now let's read Genesis 4, verse 1. And we read that already. And Adam knew his wife, and they conceive and bear a child, and his name was Cain. And we studied something interestingly last week in our lesson where it said that Eve supposedly thought that Cain was the promised Messiah. And this argument, because, you know, there's a theory as well that there may have been other children who were born prior to Cain and Abel. But I would say so if it would have been a female, a daughter. Why? Because if you realize, this son who would have been the first son, he was special to the mom so much that she thought of him to have been the promised Messiah. So if there would have been another before him, another male, wouldn't she have thought that that other male who would have been the first one would have been the promised Messiah? That would have seemed more logical to me. So I would agree, or I would at least lean to the argument that if children were born before Cain and Abel, it would have had to have been daughters and not necessarily son. Genesis 4, verse 2 speaks about the birth of Abel. So how many persons do we have in the play now? Four. Still four persons. Adam, Eve, and Cain and Abel. There is no mention of any other human being in the Bible at this point. Let's go on. But we notice, Genesis 4, we are getting to the meat of the matter. And this one I want somebody to read for me. Genesis 4, verse 14. Somebody quickly read this one, because now we are getting into the real meat of the matter. And we are trying to answer this question now. Who was Cain afraid of? Genesis 4, verse 14. Quickly, somebody. Genesis 4, verse 14. Microphone. Thank you very much, Brother Lewis. Four persons.
Behold, thou hast driven me out this day.
Could you speak a little bit louder and directly in the microphone?
Behold, thou hast driven me out this day from the face of the earth, and from thy face shall I be hid. And I shall be a fugitive and a vagabond on the earth, in the earth. And it shall come to pass that everyone that findeth me...
Pause right here. That's where the issue is now. That's where the issue is now. You can sit for a while, sister. Cain, having heard the verdict of God, that you are cursed, and he's saying that you're a vagabond. And Cain, who would have slew his brother, was now fearful of similar fate. But Cain now brings an argument which seems difficult to come to grips with. He said that whosoever, now since Adam and Eve were the only persons created, and then Cain and Abel was now the ones born, four persons, and we are talking about after Abel's death, which means that now it is what? Three. So who is he afraid of? Who is he afraid of? Whosoever shall find me, shall slay me. Who is he referring to there? What about those who are online? I see 35 of you online. What are you saying? Who? He was referring to his brothers and sister. All right. So that's a comment from the audience that it was his brothers and sister. Brother Shippy, go ahead. Use the mic. Microphone.
I strongly believe that Cain was thinking. And he's thinking about the future down the road. What would have happened? I don't believe Cain was looking at the direct time when he was speaking these words.
All right, thank you very much. Put this up for me now inside there. Let's look at this. Three possibilities which suggest who Cain was speaking of that may slay him. Number one, not seeing the slide up there. Number one said that he could be speaking what? He could be speaking what? Futuristic, right? So in other words, he foresaw a populated earth. And so he was speaking more in the future tense. Something that has not yet happened, but will eventually happen. That's one of the possibilities. Because remember that the command to be fruitful and multiply was given when? Before sin, but it started happening after sin. So I believe that Cain would have at least known about this instruction, that his parents were given a command that they were supposed to populate the earth. And bear in mind too that even when God would have revealed to Adam and Eve the whole plan of salvation, they would have seen a populated earth. Because they would have had to have seen the misery and the mayhem that sin would have caused. So they would have seen a populated earth from the prophecy that Christ would have given them in Genesis 3 verse 15. Right? So no doubt that Cain could possibly have known about this. Now watch this too. Adam did the same thing in Genesis 2 verse 24. What does that say? Therefore, watch me. We're talking about speaking prophetically or speaking futuristically. Adam took the same approach in Genesis 2 verse 24. What does that say? And this was after the marriage ceremony. It says, therefore shall a man leave his father and his mother and shall cleave unto his, and they shall be one. Could he be talking about him and his wife alone, the fact that they were the only ones there? How? Microphone. Because this statement that Adam made right here would have been before even sin. A birth.
Exactly. So this statement here has to be also spoken of in its futuristic context on the premise of the instruction given that men were supposed to procreate. So it was understood that multiplication would have happened and the earth would have become populated based on that principle that they themselves, probably they had not started yet, obviously, but they would have seen the animals procreating and say, oh, all right, male and female sheep bring about a number of lambs and so on. And they would have seen it around them. They would have seen birds, they would have seen everything else.
Thank you very much. Let me take some comments from online. Thank you very much for joining us, Pastor Taylor. Of course, he's saying that they could be speaking in the future, right? And another tickling thought is that too, that he could have been speaking about other persons whom God had created, which were not mentioned in the Bible. Amoya G saying that Cain was afraid of God the Almighty. All right, back to the point you made, Brother Lo, that they would have seen, even from the animals, procreation, we assume, because the Bible never actually told us that it happened. So they would have at least seen procreation. So they knew that procreation must happen. So again, we are saying that Adam is speaking futuristically as well. And that was the same thing that, well, we are proposing that could be the same approach that Cain took by saying that eventually, because one of the things that the Bible didn't tell us, it didn't give us the time span between the events. So it didn't tell us that on the second week, sin came in. It never told us that at the very time when Cain left from the presence of God, he found a woman. It didn't say that it was 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 years or whatever. It leaves that area, that space blank, wherein we cannot attach a time period to say that it was 5, 6, or 10 years, 20 years or whatever. Right? But, go ahead, Brother Shipper. Let's take your point.
I repeat again what Cain had said to the Lord.
Hey, hold your point. And I'm going to pick up something that Pastor Taylor just said. Yeah. He said that, speaking about what Adam said when he was speaking futuristically about a man shall leave his mother and father. You see the word shall?
Yes.
The word shall is a powerful word. Shall.
Ask English teachers. That's where I am.
All right, go ahead since you're on it.
Cain said to the Lord, and it shall come to pass, if anyone find me, they shall. That word is a broad space. We do not know if it's a year or two, 10 years, 15 or 40 years. So that word for shall and future words, we cannot put a number of time to it.
All right, thank you. The word shall, you're going to deal with the word shall? All right, hold on. The word shall, as used in Genesis 4:14 and Genesis 2:24 here, where Cain said that whomsoever find me shall, and where Adam said, therefore shall a man. The word shall is a future word. I shall come. Am I there? But guess what? The word shall speak of something in the future as though it is currently happening. So you are sure that it will come. Jesus uses the very same word, I shall return. So he's not here yet, but there's no shadow of a doubt that it shall come to pass. So Adam and Cain, we are seeing here, are acknowledging that they don't come yet. They are not there yet. But it shall come to pass that the earth will eventually be populated. Brother Lou.
Right. I wanted to focus on verse 24 a little bit. That we should not assume that this verse is also an extension of what Adam has said. It could also be what the writer, Moses, has been narrating. For instance, Adam is saying, this is no bone of my bones, flesh of my flesh. And he stops because she shall be called woman because she was taken out of man. And if we imagine that Adam stops speaking there, then we could also qualify, because what we don't have is the benefit of quotation marks. But if we look at the context of the other two verses, you realize that it's not necessarily Adam speaking. So, therefore shall a man leave his father and mother. Could be Moses speaking to his present day audience. And he continues to narrate in verse 25, they were both naked. He's describing the situation, but he's also qualifying the condition that was given in the beginning to say this is how, from the beginning, we were expected or ordained to operate as human beings.
Thank you very much. All right, we have 25 minutes. The time is moving so fast. Thank you very much, Sister Campbell. Sister Campbell is saying that she's agreeing that Cain and Adam were indeed speaking in the future tense, and Arnold Stewart is saying the Bible didn't say that both had children before sin. The Bible didn't say that both had children before sin. We did confirm that it was actually after sin that procreation actually started. So number one possibility is that Adam could be speaking in the future tense. Number two possibility is that daughters were born unto Adam and Eve somewhere within the period of Cain and Abel. However, it was not mentioned, as emphasis is usually placed on the male, as we have seen that Seth's birth was recorded and Seth's children and then the children of Seth and so forth. And number three possibility is that it could be that the issue was not placed in chronological order again. Now, how did Cain find a wife? That's another issue we want to look on. Two theories propose. It may be an angel, fallen angel, or it may be his sister or some other female member of his family. So let's look at the two proposed answers to this. The gender of angels is different from how the human gender is understood. They are what we call neuter, meaning that they are neither male nor female, but they can take on whichever gender they so desire. However, the Hebrew and Greek word for angel is always male. If you have found in the Bible anywhere where an angel was referred to in the feminine gender, show it to me. I have never seen where an angel, the Bible uses an angel in the feminine gender, right? Michael, the archangel, we at least know the name of two angels. Three, Michael, Lucifer, and Gabriel. Right? And all of them were what? Male. The ones who went to Samson, we're going to look at a few of them, to Samson's mother was a male. Gabriel announced the birth of Jesus and many other instances. Those who came to Abraham about the issue of Sodom and Gomorrah, they were male. As a matter of fact, remember when they went down there and the men down there say, we see two young men coming to you, man, send them out to us. They were male. So the Bible, the word angelos, and the Hebrew word malak are both masculine nouns, translated angels or messengers from God. All right, sister. Yes, thank you very much. Male again. And Amoya is agreeing with Pastor Taylor. Could be Moses narrating with Adam and Eve to current Moses' time and future generation. And that was something also that Brother Miguel Lowe was mentioning, right? So here are some examples. Genesis 19, Lot and the angels. Luke 1, 26 to 38, announcement of Jesus' birthday. Birth, rather. Mark 16, 3 to 6, the resurrection of Jesus. All of these, the Bible accounts that the angels were actually male, right? So what did Jesus say concerning humans being like angels in the book, in the new earth? Matthew 22, verses 23 to 30. Quickly, let's jump right there. Matthew 22, verse 23 to 30. And we're not going to read all of it in the interest of time. Matthew 23, verse 23 to 30. And this, of course, was an argument that Jesus was having with some of the scribes and the Pharisees when they said that Moses' law said that when a man dies and he has no children, his brother ought to marry that woman and raise up offspring. Because, you know, we understand that to be childless in Bible days was almost like a curse. Especially if you don't have a male, it was almost like a curse. So to preserve the woman's dignity and to ensure that there is somewhat of provision for her, the law of Moses would have permitted that the brother of the dead husband, marry her, impregnate her. And they say, what if she marry again and then him dead and him marry again and marry again and marry again. And at the end of the day, she have six husbands. Seven husbands. What will happen in the resurrection? Now fight that when everybody come up and Mary Jane and Billy Brown is saying, it's my wife. And Mark Brown come and say, when you're dead, me marry her. And then Samuel come up and said, no, man, it's my wife. I marry her in the year 17, whatever, whatever. And the next man come up and say, no, it's my wife. Whose wife? No one next controversy that we are going to have again. So Jesus said that we shall be like what? Angels. Why should we like be like angels? Let's read the text. Let's read the text. Because what? There shall be no what? No marriage are given into marriage. So angels don't get married. Right? So angels don't participate in sexual relationship. And when you compare that to Isaiah 65 verse 20, it speaks about the fact that there shall be no infant born in the new earth. Isaiah 65 verse 20 speak about that. So there will be no, right? So those of us who are married have to enjoy it from here. But we won't miss anything when we go over there, because the blessings of the new heaven and the new earth will supersede all of that. Okay? Wonderful. We are getting there. We have about 20 minutes to go. So we are still arguing, because we are saying from that, we come to the conclusion, therefore, that it cannot be a who. It cannot be a who. Let me hear what the comment online are saying. Okay, no comment yet. So we are ruling out. You have a point. Microphone. Go to the microphone. Go to the microphone. You have a comment. 65 verse 20. Right? So we have ruled it out that his wife could not be an angel, right? So the next possibility that we are looking at now is, the third possibility was that it is likely that it may be his sister or some other female member of his family. So we have already seen where some information were not recorded in chronological order. Can I have the screen up, please? Let's have the screen up. We have already seen where some information were not recorded in chronological order, let's examine another account which seems not to have been recorded in chronological order. Genesis 6 verse 1, and I want someone to read this one now. Genesis 6 verse 1, can't be an angel, Brother Oliver Lewis. Genesis 6 verse 1, we are looking here to see if there was another issue with chronology of this event. Genesis 6 verse 1. And let's listen, let's follow this one keenly.
Genesis 6 verse 1.
Yes.
And it came to pass, when men began to multiply on the face of the earth, and daughters were born unto them.
Could you read that again?
And it came to pass, when men began to multiply on the face of the earth, and daughters were born unto them.
All right, wonderful. So the Bible is here saying that it came to pass that men began to multiply and daughters were born unto them. Hold your point, Brother Campbell. Hold your point, Brother Lamech. So the Bible said in Genesis 6 verse 1 that, thank you very much, Brother Stewart, angels don't marry. So it couldn't have been an angel. They can't procreate and so forth. But Genesis 6 verse 1 is telling us that it came to a time that daughters were born unto them. Now, this, however, is not the first time the Bible mentions that daughters, females, were born. Remember, we just read what? Genesis 6 verse. Come on, man, you're not with me. We just read what? Genesis 6 verse. And it said that it came to pass that when men began to multiply on the face of the earth, that daughters were born unto them. But was that the first place the Bible mentioned that daughters were born? No, it's not. Where was the first place? Genesis 5, verse 4. Two, take your hand, Brother Bernard. Genesis what? 5, verse 4. What did it say? It's, go ahead, Sister Nicola.
Genesis 5,
very interesting, Amoy.
And the days of Adam, after he had begotten Seth, were 800 and 800 years, and he begat sons and daughters.
All right, so we just read where Genesis 6 verse 1 mentioned that it came to pass when daughters were born, right? But we are going back to Genesis 5 verse 4, where it first mentioned that daughters were born. Genesis 5 verse 7 also mentions daughter. This was a daughter of Seth, who was the third son of Adam. Genesis 5 verse 10 also mentioned that Canaan had daughters. Genesis 5 verse 13 and 19 also mentioned that daughters were also born. So when we look at that, we're somehow seeing that there may be a possibility again that the events were not chronicled in the way they happened. All right, there are 2 points.
Okay, Elder, I heard you just said something, and I would like a clarification on that.
Isaiah 65, verse 20.
Did you say that in the new earth, no, there won't be any
new birth? Yes.
Okay, let me tell you what I see here.
Yes.
There shall be no more thence.
An infant.
An infant of days.
Yeah, an infant what?
Of days.
Mm-hmm. Who is an infant?
Now an old man,
all right,
not filled his day.
Mm-hmm.
For the child shall die 100 years old.
All right,
good. But the sinner being 100.
All right, let's pause there. Let's answer it quickly. I see the 2 questions here. We don't want to delay that because that's not the meat of the matter. Number one, infant babe, that refers to a young child. When a child is born, there are some stages. You have the embryo. I might mix them up. You have the embryonic stage. You have the zygote first, and then you have the embryonic stage and so forth. And then you have a child which is born, which is now an infant. So the child at its youngest stage of birth is referred to as an infant. When you start move up and down, you call him a toddler. So the infant is a baby. So when the Bible says that there shall be no infant, it means that there won't be any birth. And no old age, referring to the fact that we won't be growing any older than we are. So whatever age we go up there in, that's how we'll remain, as much as how we have it. Are you still not so clear on that? But guess what? We don't want to labor too much on that. We don't want to labor too much on that because that's not the meat of the matter. Use a microphone. Microphone. And we don't want to get distracted from Genesis 6 verse 1 account. All right, let's see what Amoy G is saying. Basically, a male with any female could also be a pregnancy with triplet, etc., causing quicker population in a short period of time. That's a strong point. Go ahead.
Yeah, I believe
we have 12 minutes.
I believe some conversation we should not encourage because to me, like this angel and man business, a dopey business that.
Okay.
Because anything starts from the beginning will not stop until God destroyed the earth. Anything start from the beginning will not stop.
Mm-hmm.
And if angel didn't have sexual intercourse with human being, it would continue until this very day.
I like that point.
The earth would full of angel baby.
And you know what I would use to back that up? The scripture in Ecclesiastes where it said that there's nothing new under the sun.
There's nothing
so new. We would have to see a repeat of it. Just like how spiritism was back in the in those days, it still exists today. So I agree with you 100%.
Because spiritism starts from the Garden of Eden. Right there, so it starts. When Satan says, you shall not surely die. All right there, so it starts. And it doesn't stop and it's going right down until Christ destroyed. And so if angel didn't have baby then, you heard a full of angel baby.
Thank you.
There are more angels upon earth, more human. There are more angels upon earth, more human. Because if one third come out of heaven, they full up the whole of earth. Some pure angel baby would have there. So adopt your argument today.
All right. Thank you very much. I've never looked at it from that perspective, but that's a solid point. I want you to do me a favor now. I want you to find 2 texts in your Bible and hold them together. We're going to read them simultaneously. Genesis 5 and 4. Genesis 5 verse 4, sorry. And Genesis 4 verse 14. Remember, Genesis 5 and 4. Genesis 5 verse 14. And Genesis 5 verse 4, F-O-U-R 4, and Genesis 4 verse 14, F-O-U-R-T-E-E-N. hold those two texts together. We're going to read them simultaneously. Now, remember where we just left off was where Genesis 6 verse 1 spoke about the fact that it came to time that daughters were born unto men. But we discover that daughters were being born long before Genesis 6 verse 1 gives the account that daughters were born unto them. Genesis 5 verse 4, Adam had sons and daughters. Now we are looking now at Genesis 5 verse 4. Let's read. I want somebody to take the microphone for Genesis 5, 4 and another one for Genesis 4, 14. Quickly, let's go. Let's have it quickly. Let's have it quickly. Let's go very quickly. One person on the left, one on the right. Quickly, Genesis 5, 4 and Genesis 4, 14. Brother Campbell is taking one. Somebody else take one quickly. Somebody else take one quickly. Genesis, which one are you taking? 5, 4, I want first. Genesis 5, 4 first. And then Sister Smith will take Genesis 4, 14. Go ahead, Genesis 5, 4. Online audience, Genesis 5, verse 4. And Genesis 4, verse 14.
After
a little louder. Speak directly in the microphone.
After he begot Seth, the day of Adam were 800 years. And he had sons and daughters. That's where it is.
Thank you very much. That is Genesis 5, verse 4. Genesis 4, 14.
Behold, thou hast driven me out this day from the place of the earth, and from thy place shall I be hid, and I shall be a fugitive and a vagabond in the earth. And it shall come to pass that everyone that findeth me shall slay me.
Good. And another text that we want to, another one that I should have inserted there was Genesis 2 verse where Cain found a wife. Let's find it there. Genesis 4 verse 17. Yes, read verse. Oh, she's gone. Verse 17 says, and Cain knew his wife, and she conceived and bear Enoch, and he built a city and so forth. So this is where it spoke about that Cain found a wife. Now, what if Genesis 4 verse 7 had come, what if Genesis 5 rather, verse 4, which speaks about the fact that sons and daughters were born unto Adam. What if that verse came before Genesis 4 verse 17 where it said that and Cain knew his wife? What if it had come? You get me? I want to say it again. What if Genesis 5 verse 4, which spoke to the fact that Adam had sons and daughters, what if it had come before Genesis 4 verse 17, which says that and Cain knew his wife? This would help us to have a better understanding that at the time when he found a wife, the earth would have been populated already. Are you following me? If it was chronicled like that, it would better help us to be of the view that the earth was populated already. Hence, he would have found a wife. Yes. I am saying that what if Genesis 5 verse 4, which states that Adam had sons and daughters, came before Genesis 4 verse 17, which says that and Cain knew his wife. So I am saying, what if Genesis 5 verse 4 was before Genesis 4 verse 17? Why? And I'm seeing where we have 6 minutes to go.
My answer to that is not likely.
Mm-hmm.
And my reason is, who was Seth?
Mm-hmm.
Seth was Adam's son.
Yeah, the third.
But he was basically Abel's replacement.
Mm-hmm.
Good? Which means that he would have come after Cain and Abel. He would have come mm-hmm. after both of them. Therefore, it would not have been logical to imagine that this would have been his sons and daughters.
But the point is that is we don't know at which point Seth was born.
Precisely. But look at Adam's age, right?
The age still do have
a... I know. Look at Adam's age. Adam was 130, right?
Yes.
Adam was 130.
And by the way, being 130,
yes,
then would have probably been like just in your prime.
Yeah, it's a long time.
Just in
right?
your prime. Because he lived for 800 years.
But mind you, I'm going to agree with you on the premise that the daughters were not identified by name, right? So daughters...
And I did make that point.
Yes.
I did make that
However, in the pure significance of the discourse, if you look at the excitement generated over the first child that was born, it's not likely that any daughters were born first, prior to either Cain or Abel. One.
But well, then, we can't say that either, because just as you made mention, we can't say it conclusively,
right.
Because from what we are seeing is right. that daughters were less significant. So there could have been a possibility somehow, we are not saying it could have been a possibility that daughters at least were born prior or somewhere at the point before Genesis 4, verse 17.
I think the main thing here, though, is to understand that from Cain's point of view,
mm-hmm.
that populace that he would have needed to choose a wife from, one, or to fear being hunted by other men, would not have been present as yet.
Okay. And we know we can safely say that thank you very much, Amoy G. We can safely say, I just lost my chain of thought. It will come back. All right, so very good. So we are saying that if Genesis 5, verse 4, I want to know that you're understanding me, you're getting what I'm saying? That if Genesis 5, verse 4 had come before Genesis 4, verse 14, particularly, put up by the screen for me, particularly this the part that made a reference to Adam had sons and daughters, that part particularly. So it would have made it better for us to understand that by the time that Cain found a wife and knew her, he would have been in an earth which was already populated. So it wouldn't have been an issue for us to debate where he had gotten a wife from. But there's still an issue again, is to who is she? Where would he have gotten her? Wonderful. So let's have one discussion, brethren. Let's have one discussion. We have 3 minutes to go. From the creation of man and woman in the Garden of Eden, they were told to procreate. So the earth could be populated. Genesis 1:28. There have been theory that other persons were on earth along with Adam and Eve at some point in creation. However, there is no proof to support that, because we highlight that it was Adam and Eve, Cain, Abel. So anywhere anybody would have been born before, it would have had to be daughters somewhere between Cain and Abel. One is there, one. You have to go to the microphone. 2 minutes to go.
Okay. Let me look at the story between Cain and his wife. Knowing his wife.
One question. One thing. Cain didn't went far from his parents. Well, wherever he went away from them and away from the presence of God. But of course, as you rightfully said, he would still probably be able to go anywhere near there or whatever. Go ahead.
Okay. He has a son and he built a city.
Mm-hmm.
And he called the city after the son name.
Nod.
Now, for instance, there are many things that doesn't make mention here. Lot of things. So we have to be careful now of how we look at Cain and his wife and the period of time when he was having his wife.
Fully agree.
Because for a man to have a child and build a city and just go build one little drain. And you look on some city, large city, and tell how big it is. So that means a whole heap of people must be populated at the time that they could build a city, okay?
Yeah. And remember Genesis 6 verse 1 speaks of a populated earth, and it came to time that the men begin to multiply and daughters were born to them. So it was speaking of a populated earth. Adam and Eve, being the foreparents of humanity, they were the foreparents of humanity. See your hand, but I have about 50 seconds to go. Whomever Cain was afraid of, Mary, put up this slide. Put up this slide for me, Brother Smith. Adam and Eve are the foreparents of humanity. Whomever Cain was afraid of, Mary, and had children with, had to have been someone from his. Had to have been someone from his. There's no way around it. No way around it. Many Bible scholars have argued this to be one of his sister. This is what they have argued it to be, that it is his sister. And I want to deal with one point, because I know somebody might be asking, so wasn't that incest, and God say that incest is wrong and so forth? Seventh-day Adventist commentary, Cain knew his wife. The sudden mention, and this again kind of consolidate my point that I was making. I see the hand, but I can't take any more because it is scheduled already that AY must begin at that time. Hold on. The sudden mention of Cain's wife creates no problem. Chapter 5, verse 4, stating that the sudden mention of Cain's wife creates no problem. Why? Because chapter 5, verse 4 states that Adam begot sons and daughters beside the three sons that were mentioned. Hence my argument that there may be an issue with chronology. Hear this now, and this is coming from the commentary again. The earliest inhabitants of earth had no... Put up the slide, please. Slide, please. Let's read that together. 1, 2. The earliest inhabitants of earth had no other choice than to marry their brothers and sisters in order to fulfill the divine command. Can't facilitate any other questions at this time. Can't go any further. It is scheduled and locked that AY should begin at this time. Right? So from this, we should be able to testify and prove that the Bible is indeed God's inspired book, and it is trustworthy, and it has given us sufficient information to prove itself and indeed to save our souls. Shall we pray? I invite you to stand with me. Father in heaven, we give you thanks for this study of your word. We will trust your word, we will stand by it, we will live by it, and we will search the scriptures. For in the scriptures, they testify of you, who is the author and finisher of our faith. As we now transition from Bible class to AY, we invite your presence here to remain and abide with us still. And may you bless the presenters and the presentation of this AY program. And may we all benefit and be better children of yours. Thank you for hearing and for answering our prayers. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you very much to our online viewers. Thank you very much, Pastor Taylor, Sister Campbell, Sister Messum, Annette Stewart, and definitely Amoy G for your comments and your feedback. We're awaiting AY at this time.
When the road is long and heavy, when it's dark and darkened, see clearly I will lift my eyes to thy ears from whence to my help cometh. My help comes.
Good evening, everyone. Happy Sabbath, and welcome back to church. We are about to begin the evening's program, and I would like to invite you to stand with me where you are, as we will open with hymn 428, Sweet By and By. Please stand. There's a land that is fairer than day, and by faith we can see it afar. For the Father waits over the way to prepare us a dwelling place there. Here we go. There's a land that is fairer than day, and by faith we can see it afar. For the Father waits over the way to prepare us, a dwelling place there. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. In that sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful, we shall sing on that beautiful shore. We shall sing on that beautiful, the melodious songs of the, and our spirits shall sorrow no more, shall sorrow, not a sigh for the blessing of rest, for the blessing of rest. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. In that sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful, to our bountiful Father above, to our bountiful Father, we will offer a tribute of praise, offer a tribute for the glorious gift of His love, this gift of His, and the blessings that hollow our days, blessing that hollow our days. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. In that sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beauty. One more time, in that sweet, in that sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. In that sweet
please remain standing for the scripture reading. Okay, good afternoon, and happy Sabbath, everyone. The scripture reading is taken from Matthew 11, verse 28 to 30. And it reads thus, "Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest unto your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." Here endeth a reading of the Lord's holy word. Now with my saying.
Please bow your heads for prayer. Dear Heavenly Heavenly Father, thank you for everything you've done. Thank you for letting us see another EY, dear Lord. The rain is falling. I know that it's a blessing, dear Lord, and I pray that you continue to pour your blessings upon us, and please let us enjoy this EY program that is in store for us. In your name I pray. Amen.
Drill. Aim the advent message to all the world in my generation. Motto, for the love of Christ compels me. Pledge, loving the Lord Jesus, I promise to take an active part in the work of the Adventist Society of my church, doing what I can to help others and to finish the work of the gospel in all the world. Song, Adventist youths are we.
Today, a man moves on. Today, he takes a step to be a better person. Today, a man places all of his strength in God to fortify himself in the Word and receive wisdom as promised in Ecclesiastes 2, verses 26. Today, a man prays for those in his past that had led him down the path of destruction. Today, he laughs at the misguided instructions to conceal and not feel. He also smiles at the bright future ahead of him, now that he is aware that his mind is the most powerful asset that God has given him. Today, a man is healed. Today, a man moves on to heal others. Good afternoon, everyone. Now, I would like to welcome you all to another AY program. As we have been doing for the last couple weeks, we've been focusing on mental health and the stigmas around it. And this evening, we will be focusing on the men, mental health. So we'll be focusing on the men and the struggles that men face with their mental health issues. And we'll be having a panel of men who will be discussing these topics, and I would like for you all to, I hope that everyone who is here and who is viewing online, that you enjoy, you learn something, and you enjoy the discussion, because it is very important for us to discuss these things and to help each other, and today the men to move on. The theme for today is the silent killer, real man Nabal, and it will be hosted by Michael Chores. Now, for those who are not aware, my name is Sean Coy. I am a psychology major at the Northern Caribbean University. And for today, I did a little research, and it came to my knowledge that we talked about suicide last week, but that was broad. For men in Jamaica, it is 3.3 on average. That's the average, 3.3 for every 100 persons. So that's, there are 3 million people in Jamaica. So that is, when you multiply that by the, multiply up the numbers, that is still a lot of people, a lot of men who take their own lives each year. And as Sister Ray said last week, there are probably a lot more who have tried it and weren't successful. So as we go into the program this evening, I hope that you really do learn a lot, and that we can leave here better people. Before we go to Brother Michael Chores, we will have a special song by Brother Robert Stephen.
Me, I need you right away. I need you now. I need you now. I need you now. I need you now. Not another second or another minute, not an hour or another day. Lord, I need you right away. If I've never needed you before, to show up and restore all the things that I've let slipped while I was yet searching the world for more of the truest friend that I have. Indeed, you're my best friend. I know in need, I stretch my hands to thee. Come rescue me, I need you right away. Agony of being alone, the fear of doing things on my own, the tests and trials that come to make me strong. guilt, hurt, shame, and defeat. The ways of trials, it beats upon me. But to know, Lord, that in you I've got victory, yes. I need you now, Lord, I need you now. I need you right now, right now, right now. I need to know. Not another second, not another minute, Lord. Can't wait another day, no, no. Oh, no, no, no. Oh, Lord. Please make way, yeah, yeah, yes. Oh Lord, oh Lord, oh Lord, yes. I'm on my bended knees, yes. I need you right away.
Good afternoon, good evening, good night, good morning, wherever it is that you're watching from. Good afternoon and happy Sabbath, everyone here present. My name is Mikkel Trowers, and I will be your host for this evening. And may I just say what a privilege it is for me to have this title. The topic that we have to discuss this evening is a heavy one. It is a heavy one. If you have been following the program or the programs over the past few weeks, you will note that we have been focused on mental health and different aspects of mental health. Now, when the camera goes wide, you will notice that sitting to my left and right, I am flanked on both sides by men, all men. And so this evening we intend to put the men in mental health, right? So we're going to be focused on the theme for this evening is the silent killer. Remember now, we're still on mental health, and the theme is the silent killer. Real man no ball. Now, yeah, so that's our theme. Real men no ball. But we're here to talk truth this evening. And the intention is to have an open, honest discussion with our gentlemen about mental health issues that are faced by men across the world. Particularly this evening, however, within our church. Now, I'm going to, before we get into the program, allow the gentlemen sitting next to me to introduce themselves. And we're gonna start with the gentleman sitting to my far right, and we're gonna make our way across in the order in which we're sitting.
I am Miguel Lou.
I'm Bertram Calvert.
Mikhail Washington.
Raheem Smith.
Sean Coy.
Robert Stephen.
All right, and thank you, gentlemen. Thank you for joining us for this discussion this evening as well. Now, let me just say that the objective really for this program this evening is to raise awareness about the mental health issues that are faced by men and to reduce or ultimately remove the stigma that is attached to men and mental health issues. As we know, not just in our churches, not just across Jamaica, but right across the world, there is this stigma that men are not supposed to cry, or men don't show their emotions as do females, or they're not supposed to, rather. And if they do, something is wrong with them. So the intention then is to break that the stigma this evening. And we want to hear from you as well as we go through the program. Now, without further ado, let's get right into it. And I want to ask my panelists this evening, I want to open with the question of what comes to mind when you hear the term mental health? Or tell me, what does mental health mean to you? And I'm going to start, let's do it this way. We're going to go Robert, Miguel, Sean, Calvert, Smith, and Washington. Let's do it that way.
All right. I'm going to take it from a psychosocial aspect. As it relates to how persons of our color, I don't want to use a colloquial term,
right.
Black, right? But for persons our tone, when it comes down to mental health, it is somewhat seen as something that we should not have.
No. Mm-hmm.
If you are somewhat stigmatized with the term of being mental, aka you're mad. Mm. Once you're mad, you don't belong in the streets. You belong somewhere tied up, locked away, and somewhat taken away from normal society.
Mm-hmm.
However, if we should actually look at it now from the basis of definition, it's to the point of where it's not even as chronic as we want to look at it. It's just based on the fact that there seems to be a level of instability or a level of unstableness within the mind.
Mm-hmm.
It's to the point of where you're thinking probably too hard on something that may be seen as quote unquote simple,
mm-hmm.
or it may just be onto the pact of where it reaches the degree of where you need some level of intervention. So that is how we can basically look at mental health.
I just want to complain that I was tricked into coming here this evening. the daughter of Eve who contacted me said that we'd be discussing emotions. If you had ever allowed the term mental health to come out of your mouth, you would not see me. Because, you know, I'm one defensive. No, that's not me, you know.
Yeah.
And I think that's the case with most men, that we take the higher road, so to speak, pride, which might not necessarily be the higher road, but we tend to avoid the stigmatizing of our being, that you and this idea that you are not in touch with your emotions. Mm. I've by the way, before we continue, I just make it clear, I might cry this evening, because okay. I'm very much in touch with my emotions now. I refuse to be robbed any further.
Praise God.
Will Smith, right?
Okay.
Sean.
Well, good points said so far, but from a definition point of view, mental health is not the absence of like a mental illness.
Mm-hmm.
It's not just that. It's a whole state of being. You know, your mind is healthy. Your mind is healthy. Your practice. If you're in good mental health, you practice good habits. You smile a lot. You show your emotions on full display. A lot of times when we think about mental health, we think about, oh, me no dead on a Bellevue, or me no mad, or mm-hmm. it's not up in here.
Right.
Oh, if you're stressed. If you have a high level of stress constantly, you're not mentally healthy.
You're not in good mental health. So it's not just, say, you're not tied up in a mental institution. It's more than that, to say.
All right. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Sir Calvin.
Okay, so as Sean mentioned, it goes far beyond just being free. As Sean mentioned, it goes far beyond just having good mental fortitude. It's more than that, right? And as you mentioned, smiling, I mean, I would like to think I have good mental health, and I don't smile that much, so taking offense to that, sir. But, you know, it is what it is. When I think about mental health and what it means to me, it's basically to be free from insanity, as, you know, it goes, as I mentioned, it goes before, far more than that, but being, I don't want to say just like as a Jamaican or so, you don't really put that much importance on mental health. You just think about it from not being insane, you know, walking up and down naked or something like that. We don't really view it from the point of being fully cognizant of what you're doing, you know, interacting with the people around you from a certain standpoint. To be mentally healthy, to have good mental health, you know, you have to be able to communicate, function properly, and all of that. So be happy. Have positive vibes, practice good, geez, just as Sean mentioned. So yeah, that's it.
All right. Thank you so much. Rick, Pastor?
All right. Thank you. So Dr. Neil Nelly wrote a book called The Lost Art of Thinking. And the premise of the entire book is that our thoughts impact our feelings, mm-hmm. and our feelings impact our behavior. And so to me, optimal mental health is someone that they're thinking balanced thoughts. And if you're thinking correctly, then your emotions and your behavior will also be appropriate.
Right.
But what something I find out that might be shocking to many persons is that it's possible for us. It's possible for individuals to actually be thinking incorrectly. And that's why the book is called The Lost Art of Thinking. So if we're not thinking truthful thoughts, that will lead us to actually have impaired mental health. That leads to depression, anxiety, mm-hmm. and a whole host of other possible complications.
Thank you so much. Thank you. And finally, Sir Washington.
All right. Good evening again, guys. I'm in agreement with what all my brothers have said so far. And for me, when you talk about mental health, it's really where you are in your mind, in your state of mind. So it's relative when you say mental health by itself. So because you can have good mental health or bad mental health. So when you say mental health, it's just where you are in your state of mind or and how it affects you. Right. So in summary of what you all said, which is correct, I am in agreement.
All right. Thank you so much, gentlemen. Now, to carry on the conversation, you know, it is usually said that men have a difficult time, as Miguel had mentioned earlier, men have a difficulty connecting with their emotions. Or it goes even farther than that. Men have a real issue even talking about things that really bother them. You know, some of the stressors that they face on a daily basis, men tend not to talk as much, perhaps, as females would. And so, you know, we bottle it in, and, you know, it leaves us in a state then that can be considered questionable on the scale of, you know, mental stability. One of the questions I want to ask this evening, as it relates to how we connect with our emotions and how we communicate the way that we feel, is on the matter of shedding tears. This is going to be a personal question. Feel free to answer honestly, because that is really what we're here to do, right? We're not here to put up a front or to put on a cover. We're here to be real this evening. So the question really is, do we find it, as men, do we find it difficult to cry? And to go further, do we find it difficult to cry in public spaces? Right? And I'm going to open this question, really, to anybody on the panel who would like to go first. This is not directed to anyone in particular.
It's hard. All right, and why it's hard is because it's what is expected, right? It's not because men are designed differently. All right? I believe that if a man and a woman sitting and they're watching a romantic comedy, for instance, right, and there are these emotive moments or any kind of drama movie, and you reach these high points and the orchestra swells and your heart feel lifted up and you really want to cry, and the man will just...
just get up and drink a glass of water.
The female will comfortably... that's so sweet, you know, and man just... Yeah.
Good one.
That's right.
Somebody's cutting onion somewhere.
Right.
Because this is what is expected, right? But I think, listen, the only thing that is different between us, remember the Bible says God created man, male and female, he created them, right? And doctors tell us that it is only after a certain stage of advancement that the fetus actually takes on this identity of either male or female, which means that basically we are the same, right? Which is why if you look again at the principle of one flesh, when God says, and the two shall become one flesh, they are the same. So this thing about women feeling emotions more than men is rubbish, just that we have been cultured to suppress
those emotions.
That thing.
Societal, yeah. Pretty much societal.
Thank you.
That is true, right? It is pretty much societal. I have been in two instances where I shed tears publicly, and at the end of it, I was almost embarrassed. Looking at it to the point of where the situations within itself called naturally for tears to be shed, you know? But then at the end of it, you're looking at it and you're like, when you now become conscious, you're looking around to see if there's any other male doing this, you're like, okay, I need to take a walk on the outside. Yeah, and kind of clear up myself. And yeah, and they come to you and they be like, so big man like you, Virgin, what that? Say, Virgin, me never know what take me over, Virgin. It just come, you understand?
Right.
But at the end of the day, it's just to the point of where, as I said, it's really and truly societal. And that is where there are a lot of times as males, we do find ourselves unknowingly going into what we call depression.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's to the point of where we're thinking more than likely, yeah, me not go ball about it. However, because you're going to think about it a lot, to the point of where you're going to actually start talking to yourself. And people go to sell up and like, oh, I'm just so much money. So I can't talk to yourself, so what?
Mm-hmm.
Well, of course, really and truly, if you stand there, you feel that level of emotion and the tears come, somebody may just come to you and like, okay, what is wrong? You get that freedom now just to open up whatever it is
right
that you could not say. So societal, pretty much.
I do agree that it's a societal thing. I actually had to recently relearn how to cry.
Mm-hmm.
Because when I was little...
Hold on. Let me break you there for a second. I need you to explain, for the sake of us and everybody else who is listening, what do you mean when you say you had to relearn how to cry?
In a sense where I was not crying at all. I would go through something and I would just, you know... Not break stuff. I would just sit in a corner,
mm-hmm,
and people would look at me and say, oh, you look like you want to kill somebody.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I just sit in a corner and process it by myself, and then I come back. But it had reached a point where I had reached a point in my life where I really felt like I was going insane.
Mm-hmm.
And I had to really just really... be on myself and say, Sean, you're in private, it's okay to bawl. Probably in public, people might judge you, but you're in private, nobody knows. See you.
Let it go.
Right? Yeah. Not even in private, I would do it.
Mm-hmm.
And really, that's the kind of thing, because when I was little, people in the church know that I used to cry a lot.
Mm-hmm.
Anything I cry over. And I used to get teased for it, and people used to come and say, make your bar for toughen up, man. Exactly, your body, your staff. Huh?
Mm-hmm.
I had to, you know, toughen up, especially when I went to an all-boys school. And you know, say, you can't really show emotion there. So
let me just add something to what you're saying, my brother. Mm-hmm. I don't mean to cut you, but I don't want to lose the point. It's a very technical issue, you know. It's very technical because
people will say that women go through a roller coaster of emotions. That happens with men as well. You will always have forums like this where we say, oh, it's okay to cry. It's okay to do this. It's okay to do that.
Go out the door and cry.
No, let's just put it at the point where domestic abuse. Mm-hmm. If your wife, God forbid, thump in your eye, and you go to the station and report that, you see, you're laughing because you know what's going to happen. You know exactly what's going to happen.
It goes further. You go reporting.
And they do nothing.
Crying.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, you go reporting.
Them video crying.
Yeah.
Weak. That makes it even worse. Yeah. And we just left from the forum saying that it's okay to cry. So people will always do this, but when they go out there, it's something different. So I'm saying, though we might have the platform
to talk about it,
mm-hmm. though we might display that we can emote in public, we can show emotions through crying,
right. We
don't embrace it outside of the forum.
Right.
Because the society is already, I would say, set in stone. You know?
Yeah.
So what he's saying is that relearning to cry is basically trying to control when it is okay to cry then. So I understand what he's saying, and we might find it a bit amusing and we might laugh, but it's a very, very serious issue.
It is.
Studies have been done all around the world, and it shows that there's a high percentage of men that, you know, commit suicide, and this is because of stress. Because I don't want to go to Miguel and say, boy, you know this and that, because when I look at him, he looks like a macho type of male, and so I can't go to him with a weak statement to say that, you know, I'm feeling this type of way or feeling mm-hmm. that type of way, mm-hmm. and then you see me on the newspaper dead.
Right.
So it's a very, very serious and very, very technical issue. So we ought to take it serious.
I agree. Pastor, I noticed you wanted to say something. Sean, you were finished?
All right, so let me just go ahead. I remember that from around the age of 5 to the age of maybe around 16, in the space of 11 years, mm-hmm. I lost 5 close family members.
Wow.
When I say close, I grew up in an extended family. Mm-hmm. So I grew up with my 2 paternal grandparents. I grew up with aunts and uncles, that type of thing. I lost my 2 paternal grandparents, lived in the same house. I lost 3 uncles.
Wow.
And at that stage, I'm a young boy, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But I actually never cried for any one of them save one uncle. And even for the one uncle that I had cried for, I had not cried at the funeral. It wasn't until months afterwards, I found myself walking in the house and crying. I never asked me, what's the matter? Why are you crying? And all I'm saying, Uncle Chetty dead. Like, and that was like 3 months after the funeral. What I did not know was that I was bottling up those emotions until it reached a point where they just came out.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a really serious situation. If I can just add a biblical perspective.
Absolutely.
I was thinking, on the way here, I was thinking about males crying in the Bible. And the only male I could think of crying in the Bible is the perfect example of masculinity, who is Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ cried, I'm thinking of two examples that the Bible mentions that he cried.
Right.
Once at the tomb of Lazarus, mm-hmm. and next when he was marching into Jerusalem, the triumphal entry, the mm-hmm. same week he was going to be crucified. But the interesting thing about, so I'm making the point that it takes a real man to be vulnerable in a public space. That's not a sign of weakness, mm-hmm. that's a sign of strength.
Right.
Only somebody who is confident in their masculinity can be vulnerable in a public space and not feel compromised, even if other people laugh after them. But the point I want, another interesting point that came to mind is that when Jesus cried, he never cried for himself. He only shed tears publicly for other people.
Other people.
And even when they were crucifying him, when he was on his way to the cross and the women were crying on his behalf, he told them, don't cry for me. So, in other words, the same Jesus had the strength to not shed a tear when he was being tortured.
Mm-hmm.
He cried for other people, not because it's a sign of weakness, but because it actually takes strength to be vulnerable in a public space.
So what we're saying then, Pastor, is that on the contrary to popular belief, it is not the weak man that cries. It is not the weak It is not the weak man that cries, but the man who is strong enough and comfortable enough within himself to understand that it is okay to let go of those emotions, regardless of the way society views that. And that really is the mindset that we would want to leave here with. As Mikhail mentioned earlier, you know, we're going to have these forums. We're going to sit and talk about it. And as soon as we go through that door, there's a high possibility that we're going to go right back to the former way of thinking, or let me say the current way of thinking, that something is wrong with us if we feel like crying because something has happened. Now, sitting on this panel is a budding psychologist, right? Currently studying psychology at Northern Caribbean University, and I do have some questions that I want to direct at him. So, Sean Coy, I am directing these questions to you. What are some of the telltale signs of a male that may be struggling with their mental health? And I'm happy that you mentioned earlier, you know, the whole matter of having to relearn how to cry. I'm happy that you brought that out, because this is the perfect opportunity for you now to build on that for the rest of us. You know, what are some of the telltale signs of a male that may be struggling with their mental health? And how can we work on normalizing the help-seeking behavior for men? So it's a two-part question.
So I'll use a friend of mine currently committed suicide. His funeral was 2 weeks ago. And when I sit and I go through all the memories of him, we were in the same grade 10 and 11, and I went through all of the memories and see where things started going down. As I sat and I realized that there was a point where his personality just changed. His personality, he was this, you know, big bubbly guy, you know, he always laughing, always the vice. But around CSEC time, around grade 11, his whole personality changed. And at the time, you would think that, hey, it's because, you know, CSEC time and you want to settle down and, you know, exactly. But when I really analyzed it, I realized that, hey, something was wrong. And he was not even, there would be days that he would sit in a corner. I was not used to him doing that. He would sit in a corner and not talk to nobody, not do anything, not even pay attention in class, nothing. So oftentimes, I think one way is that you realize that there are certain changes, there are certain negative changes. You know, they start drawing back, they're not talking to you, you know. It can be a husband and he's going through something and you don't. And you realize that he used to come to you and talk to you, but he does not do that anymore. Or he lashes out more often. Aggression is another sign.
Absolutely.
that he's struggling with his mental health. A lot of these men that you see out here that get angry at the simplest thing, I'm sure that if you check with them, they're going through something. Mm-hmm. Right? But those are some signs. For
the help-seeking behavior.
The help-seeking
right.
behavior.
To normalize that.
Yeah, for normalizing the help-seeking behavior, I would say start from they're young, because a lot of these issues, you know, me not being able to cry or whatever, or me dealing with things by myself to the point that I feel like I will break, you know, they're bent into us from where we are little. You know, a man is supposed to stand strong and he's not supposed to show this level of weakness. I think that from their young, we need to take that away and direct it into the right angle. But even when it is a situation where it's somebody my age or older, you know, already bent into me, I would say education. You know, if you know of something that you can, some way that you can help people, and you know something, you know that, hey, you can get this for help, or so you can do something like one of these forums. You can, you know, when you're sitting down as men with your friends and it come to you that, hey, you know, bring up a discussion, broaden their level of knowledge, their view of the world. Because some men, they really don't know. They don't know that they can go here and get this. They don't know. They don't want to go to the police station because, as my brother was saying, that they're going to laugh at you, you know. But there are places where you can go and you can get help. You can either to a psychologist or you can go to I wouldn't say a clinic, but a clinic, yes, because you have psychologists and psychiatrists there.
Right.
You have counselors there.
Right.
The mental nurses, because their nurses are also trained to help to a degree. So that's what I would say, ways that we can, you know, make it more accessible and make it that the men feel more comfortable going for help.
Good talk. Okay, thank you. You wanted to add something? Okay, all right. Thank you so much, Sean. Now, I wanted to that as well. And ladies and gentlemen, you can correct me if I'm wrong, but I would like to think that us as men would so much more open to seeking help as well if we get a little bit more. I'm going to ask now for the help from our ladies. Watch me carefully. Did you know that a lot of the behavior that is exhibited by men in our society now is because a lot of women believe that this is the kind of behavior that women like to see? You believe me when I say that? You agree? Yes, it is believed that because this is the kind of behavior that women like to see, we exhibit that kind of behavior, right? Yeah, man, why pressure, as the gentlemen are saying, right? Yeah, and as Miguel mentioned earlier, there's that certain standard that we are expected to live by. There's that certain standard that we're expected to keep. So my request, as we continue with the discussion, my request is to our ladies, help us, right? Yeah, man, thank you. Yeah, man, help our brother out, right? Help us to feel normal talking, thank you, from the young age up. Because watch this, there is no age that mental health issues are not, it doesn't target at certain age. It's not partial, right? Every single age, male and female, boy and girl, can be affected by mental health issues, right? It's not partial at all. So ladies, please, if you will, help us to feel normal in ourselves. If we have an issue and we want to talk about it, if it is burdening our hearts and we want to cry about it, you know, don't make a man feel as if he is any less of a man for responding in an emotional way.
Mikel, I fear they might say man of a bali.
No, but that's the thing. That has been the mindset, you know, that has been the stigma that's associated with a man who feels like crying. Now, to the point that you raised earlier as well, it doesn't mean that a man is weak if he feels like crying. And to Sean's point, it is important as well to consider that if someone feels the need to cry, if someone feels the need to emote, it must mean that something is happening on the inside that should not be taken lightly. There is a reason that the percentage of suicide in men is higher than the percentage of suicide in women. There's a reason for that, right? Ladies, we need your help. The gentlemen who you see walking around, you have the other one? Can we get a mic to my sister here, please? The gentleman that you see walking around with their pants below their waist and they carry themselves a certain way that some of us might consider a little bit uncouth. I bet if no woman paid any attention to them, if they looked that way, they would never do it.
Right. So well, this sounds better. I bet it wouldn't happen. So yeah, man, help us, ladies. I'm coming to the audience now. We're going to be taking a point. But before we take that point, while she's getting to the mic, Bertram wanted to add to this point as well.
All right. So you mentioned about the crying before, and it was spoken about in length. But I just wanted to add this to it because I feel it's a bit important, because we're talking about it now, and the stigma will still be there that crying is a weakness and, you know, men should not cry because it shows that you're weak. But let's remove the gender from the crying, right? As human beings, crying is a natural response to pain. And not only that, crying helps to alleviate said pain. So it also releases chemicals in the body that also help you to feel good. So even if you feel like, hey, I'm not going to cry in public, or that society isn't ready for men crying, please, gentlemen, if you have to close a door or do something, go ahead. Just, you know, release your tears. And this may be a bit hypocritical coming from me, because I'm currently under an oath myself that I will never be crying again. But, you know, here today, I will probably relinquish that oath. So just do what you have to. Cry if you need to, because it helps to relieve the built-up stress that you have going on.
Precisely. It's a process. It's a growing process. And you're growing. It's good that you're able to admit that as well. There is a saying. What did they say that pressure does to the pipe? All right. And I'm not the only one who knows it, right? Pressure busts pipe, right? And we're all pipes in here, right? Just keep that in mind.
So, well, you're going to take the audience, but I wanted to follow up on that pressure bus pipe thing, because that's I think we need to start there somewhat, just revert to there, that there's no point of stress or being overwhelmed that just happens overnight.
Precisely.
All right? And part of the problem that we have, or people in general, but especially men have, is that we compartmentalize our issues, right? Right, right, Mr. Psychologist, and but part of the problem is that we don't take enough offense to things that happen, small things. So we let things slide. And before, if you're taking in 100 blocks from there to there, you only need to take them two or one at a time. After a while, you have a whole pile. And so this is how stress works. It just comes on you, and before you know it, your pipe is burst, and you don't know why. So I just wanted to go to John 18, verses 22 and 23. Here we have Jesus being interrogated in front of Annas. And Annas asks him a question, and he gives Annas an answer that causes Annas to shut up. And Annas' security come across and slap Jesus. And Jesus says, let me read it, verse 23. He says, "If I have spoken evil, be a witness of the evil. But if well, why hast thou smitten me?" All right? And this is Jesus showing us an example that you don't just take it and don't vent it. Remember now, you know, the word says, be angry and sin not. Ephesians 4:26. Good? Right. So it's important that we take an adequate or a commensurate or an appropriate level of offense to things that bother us. Truth be told, most times, me personally, I don't even know what bother me until long afterwards. You know, and so it's important, again, ladies, just a tip, don't be nagging. Silence is just a processing time, because we can't put fingers on what is wrong just yet.
Right,
or we can't put it into words. I'm offended. You know what? I don't want to talk about it now. When do you want to talk about it? I don't know. I don't know. It's just not no. So just allow it. Then my other strategy actually is to write it.
Okay.
Yes, I write it. And the reason I write it, ladies and gentlemen,
is because nobody, no woman can interrupt you when you're writing. You write it and you press send. End of story. Mm-hmm. And women will read it. They will read it. So you read over what you have to say, write it, make sure you say what you need to say, reread it, pray over it, edit it, fix it,
right.
Make sure it says what you want to say, then send it off. And believe you me, just writing it relieves some stress. Knowing that it is sent, it relieves more stress.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, because the argument, I'm not into the argument personally.
Yeah.
And, you know, but it's important to allow this time, and it's important to take offense, express it in some way or another. Some guys like to two and two. You will lose. Don't do it.
Yeah.
Just be relaxed. Take the time out, come back, have a seat, go out, do something. But settle it. Make sure it whatever is has the potential to be accumulated. Make sure it is vented properly.
Amen. Thank you so much. My sister, we are with you now for your point. Pass. Okay. I want to hear from the gentleman in the audience as well. Here's a question I want to pose to the gentleman in the audience. What are some of your methods for dealing with stress, dealing with stressors? You know, these can really help some of our gentlemen as well to learn how to vent their frustration, learn how to vent on some of the issues that we have that can cause... Oh, wow, we have somebody at the mic already. All right, wonderful. All right, Elder, what are some of your methods?
Mind your marriage.
Hold on, check if the mic is on, please.
Well, two of my methods are, which not all the time when I do them, it means that I'm stressed. I just play music in my car and play it very loud. You know, I don't want to hear anybody or anything around me. I just play it and just reason with myself, or I go swimming and go very far in the sea and probably be out there with someone and just reason. No, I'm not gonna drown. I'm out there with others. So those are some ways that I you know, using recreational app to deal with some of my issues. I just talk to myself, but not out loud. Talk to myself.
Okay. Thank you. Yeah. Thank you.
While you're waiting, I drive fast.
You drive fast.
Yeah, if I'm upset, I'll drive hard and far and fast. Yeah.
I mean, I think,
you know, well, different strokes for different folks, I guess. I
right.
mean, you know, the truth is, I know a number of persons who drive fast when they are upset. I don't know that it is for them as it is for you, a method of overcoming.
It helps.
It does.
It does.
Right. Yeah, the rush of adrenaline.
I think it's more the entertainment of overtaking everybody else.
Okay. I do know that for some persons, it happens as a natural response just to being upset. You're upset and you're in the car. You're upset at the world. You know, it's not that you're out to get anybody or you're out to get yourself. But, you know, it just happens sometimes without even noticing. But I guess it can be used as a means of, you know, addressing.
Obviously, this can't happen in Mobe, right? Because traffic.
Yeah, there's no place. There's no space in Mobe for it. So,
right.
And I don't advise you to take it on a North Coast highway either, right. Because that hasn't been a safe stretch.
I mean, Chowas, yeah. All right. Yeah. I think females listening on low, this is something based on the responses given, that it may give you an idea of basically what your male companion may be experiencing whenever you see a certain behavior pattern. Things that you may pretty much be annoyed at or annoyed with on the basis of where on probably a Saturday night after church, he may stay back, not habitually, but at a certain point he just decide that he wants to stay back and play domino for a few extra hours.
Yeah, it's true.
The Sunday morning, get up to go play football.
Mm-hmm.
He played Sunday morning and then get up and gone again Sunday evening. The fact that he probably may want to go out and socialize or talk to him bridging next door. If he wants to pretty much watch an EPL game and he does not do it at home, he prefers to go by the friend's house to do it. You understand? But of course, some of these, it may be on the basis of where, yes, it's a thought process, as Miguel has mentioned before. A lot of persons have their different ways, or different males have different ways of actually going through this process. And for the most part, it's to the point of where we are physical in getting over with over it. As you said, there are persons who may sit and write. Right? For the musical persons or for those who are involved in language and poetry and whatnot, they may sit and they may write and they may create something beautiful from it. But for other persons, as I say, to relieve stress or not to have that level of tension, they will go out and do something physical. Now, as it relates to the whole physical thing, I'm about to get... Let me look around. Yes. You don't want it to get to the point, brothers and sisters, you don't want it to get to the point of where, based on the lack of verbal communication, that it turns, his way of communication of relieving stress actually turns into what we call sexual intercourse. That in itself can be very dangerous. Right? And at that point, you may start thinking and questioning certain things now. You understand that? Like, why am I being someone? If you would have allowed that space of thought, and of course that space for there to be open verbal communication, because believe you me, there are males out there who have that level of drive to the point of where when pressure bust pipe,
yeah.
It was pipe for real. You understand? And it now puts you in a position to the point of where now emotionally you feel as if you're being used, when actually that is him communicating that yeah, him need to release some stress. Mm-hmm. The stress that maybe not, it wasn't brought by you. It was probably brought by somebody else, but because you are put on the pressure, the pipe does bust.
All right. Now we're gonna take.
That's a point, just to add to what the brother is saying.
Yeah, but so we're gonna because take the point that, from. Hold on, one sec. We're gonna take the point from you and Mikhail, and then Sean. And in the meantime, while you guys are making your point, right after those two points, we're gonna take a break to have a special musical item, so you can get ready for that as well, Mikhail.
Sure. To the females in the audience. Are you seeing a chain connection in what everybody is saying on this panel? Can you pinpoint the main point of some sort of stress? Remember my brother said, going out to watch a football game, and I heard a female in the crowd say, what is wrong with the TV at home? I don't think there's something wrong with the TV at home. So are you getting the point that I'm trying to make, that the stress is coming from somewhere?
Yeah, the TV at home, the TV at home somehow doesn't look as good as the ones that
over my friend.
Yeah, over your friend house.
It just bigger.
The definition, yeah, I don't know. Something, yeah.
Right. So we said it earlier that we need the help from the females. Yeah. So I'm showing you that without even mentioning it again, it's coming out naturally. Because nobody up here said that, they're having conflicts with their brothers.
Right.
Conflicts with their male counterparts.
Right. No, no.
It's stemming mostly from one place.
Yeah, the problem with that, us men...
hold on, I don't mean to cut you. You realize that
people
are not happy with this statement?
Yes.
So that means there's some fact to what I'm saying?
Yes.
Okay.
Just so that, just as a disclaimer, we did not have a session before to discuss...
Yeah, there's no conspiracy.
...where we would go with this discussion.
Right.
Right. So just so that you are aware, We didn't decide to come up here and just bash anybody, but we are having an open discussion, you know, and these are men talking, and it is important that men understand what men go through as well as females understand what men go through and how it is that we ought to work together to deal with these issues. Amen? All right, now, Elder, I see your hand, and I'm going to come to you. We did have a point here. All right, so we're going to take the point from Sean, then we come to you, Elder, and then we'll take the song.
All right, so you raise a point of ways to relieve stress, but the thought came to me that even in what we do to relieve stress, it should not be, it shouldn't be endangerment, and it shouldn't be you avoiding the problem. It shouldn't be, a lot of times, even with myself, sometimes I will just leave the problem for later. You know, I go watch some TV or I do something, and it's not me dealing with the problem, it's me avoiding the problem. And it shouldn't be that, because then it's going to come to the point that pressure busts by, you know, and you don't want it to get there. So dealing with the stress, yes, sometimes it might come to a point where you'll have to like put it for a later date or take your time and process it. But it should never be you constantly avoiding the problem.
Thank you so much. Elder, are you ready? You may take the stand, sir.
When I was much younger, I got to start from there. I didn't know how to handle these things. And so I find myself sitting up on my veranda at 2 o'clock in the morning, counting how much land and how much getting up. Couldn't handle it. But as I grow older, I realize that there are some battles that you must not fight. Because if you try to fight them mentally, it's going to impact you greatly. So you find a way out to de-stress. If you ask me one of my ways, I play cricket for years. So no matter what problems I might have anymore during the week, come weekend, we play senior cup and we play junior cup. All of my friends, them did it. Whatever problem you have, whosoever one have, may not have no problem. It is a play cricket for years. But after I leave the construction site, cricket field, and I come into the church, why some greater stress hit me, you know? Serious stress. Stress that even my very kidneys were hurting me. Serious situations. Yes. I found my body at one time drying out. Yes. Whilst coming to this very church. And if you want to know how to get over it, I learned to have self-control. If you do not have self-control, stress will drain you out. As a matter of fact, I reached a point where there was a sore right here. Right here. So when I come like this, you could feel it open inside. I didn't go to any doctor. I was a member of this church. Serious times for me. And little by little, I learned to have self-control. I didn't try to use sex. I stopped smoking then. I wasn't drinking any alcohol. It is just self-control. Control your mind. And tell you what, you got to talk to people too. If you got a good friend who can take the weight that you have, because not everybody can manage it, you can empty out on them or you empty out on them. The good friends will give you good words of comfort, words of life, words of hope, and you can go back feeling lighter. Well, if you ask me where I am now, life is beautiful. And if you ask me why is life so beautiful, people who I don't have to deal with, I leave them out of my mind. And my house is a peaceful place. Yes. Thanks to mums over there. Hey.
I am endorsing her publicly.
That's right.
So if you ask me if you have no stress now, little is there. But guess what? When you go home, to be honest with you, I am a greater peacemaker now than a man who will war. But I am uncompromising when it comes to moral and spiritual principles. So that's the problem we have in the church with mostly young people, but most of them are afraid now. That's true, China. Most of them are afraid now. I am not prepared to compromise, but it stresses me, or it stresses me when I see them going off. But it makes my heart light. Already, I see Chrissy they cry. I say, yes, Chrissy, I come home. Yes, you know, and me like China, they go on nowadays, and there are a few more. Me they call names. Well, if you see me not stressed too, me have it, but me keep it to myself, and me try to control it. But one of the problems that I see here with our young people, most of them, just like me when I was your age, they do not know how to control it, and so it got the better of them. Some of them find themselves even outside of the church seeking comfort when there is none. As a matter of fact, at times the matter gets worse than better for them. There were times when I feel stressful, brethren. I read a lot. I bury my emotions there. Nobody told me, but I went to join the St. James Library. And so when I read one book and it was finished, I return it and read another. So when you come into the church and I come across the books, I learn to read them also. So at times when my friend and my little girl and stuff like that, me alone live, me have my yard to read. So self, as a matter of fact, Ellen White goes on to say in these Avages, I think the topic was Sermon on the Mount. The greatest evidence of the nobility of a Christian is self-control. Let me repeat. The greatest evidence of the nobility of a Christian is self-control. So try to cultivate self-control and your stress will become lighter and manageable. God bless you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Elder. And right before we take the song, I think I want to come back to you a little bit later to kind of continue on that point as well, because you did raise some very valid points just now. And the truth is, as different as we are, so too are our stresses and stressors, which also means that the same pill won't work for everybody, right? It won't work for everybody. But I'm going to come back to you on that, because I would want to continue the discussion, and we're going to take points as well from the panel on how to best cultivate, what are the best means of, now this question is not on my list, but I think we want to, you know, expound a little bit more on how do we cultivate that culture of self-control, especially amongst our men here in the church. Thank you so much, Elder. We break now to take a special musical item, and then we'll be right back for round two. Stay tuned.
Seem to fall asleep. There was so much on my mind, searching for that peace, for the peace I could not find. That's when I knelt down to pray. Pray, help me please. Then he said, you don't have to cry, 'cause I'll supply all your needs. As soon as I stopped worrying, worrying how the story ends, when I let go and I let God have His way, that's when things start happening. When I stopped looking at heaven, I let go and I let God, let Him have His way. There was so much going on, sometimes I couldn't find my way. Oftentimes I struggled, struggle from day to day. I had to realize that it's my battle. It's not my battle to fight. I had to know if I put it in his hands, everything will be alright. Yeah, yeah. Soon as I stop worrying how the story ends. But I let go and I let God. Let God have his way. That's when things start happening. When I stop looking at bad things. When I let go and I let God. Let him have. Let God, let go, and let God, let go, let God, oh, let go, and let God, let go, and let God, my brother, let go, and let God, my sister, you can handle it, let God, oh, let go, and let God. Let go, and let God, just let go, and let God, when you go on your knees, just let God, when you pray to him, just let God, with tears in your eyes, just let God, know you can handle it, just let God, when you pray on your knees, and you give it to him. Worrying how the story ends. But I let go and I let God have his way. That's when things start happening. I start looking at bad things. But I let go and I let God have his way. Stop worrying about the things of the past. When I stop thinking about the things I can't control, I let God take it over. Brought me a peace of mind. Made me have a better life. Yeah, yeah. I stop worrying about the things I can't control. I give it over to him. I let him control it. Yeah. When I let go and I let God.
Amen. Amen. Let go and let God. Thank you so much, Brother Stevens, for that beautiful rendition. If you're just joining us, let's say welcome to you. We are having a discussion this evening on mental health matters, particularly in men. So we're having it's a bit of a man talk this evening, and so we have been focused on some of the challenges that men face as it relates to mental health, and what are some of the ways that we can deal with these challenges. Now I want to take a moment to go through our YouTube chat. Let me say welcome again to those of you who are joining us on our live stream on YouTube. And so on the matter of mental health, Jaron says, mental health encompasses emotional, psychological, and social well-being. It influences cognition, perception, and behavior. It also determines how an individual handles stress, interpersonal relationships, and decision making. Thank you so much, Jaron. Vancine says, women should not be blamed for men not expressing themselves. Thank you for your comment, Vancine. It is an open discussion, and we welcome all the points, we welcome all the opinions, all sides are welcomed. Now, We want to, there is a, well, T Music R Soothes says, on one hand, females need to be able to identify the change in the male's behavior and seek to find out what's up. On the other hand, however, the males need to be willing to either have that talk or, if they need to stay in their cave for a while, communicate that to the female as well. No. So I am hearing the largest amens from the females in the congregation.
We have caves now?
Yes, so men have caves. I am hoping that the individual who made this comment is a male as well. Thank you so much for your comments. Now, when we were looking at the matter of, you know, dealing with mental health issues amongst men, Mario Wallace says, find someone to burden. Thank you, Maria. Well, we're going to be coming to you when we need to let off a little bit of steam. But thank you so much for your comments. Thank you for joining us. And we are now going to be continuing the discussion. Now, in the first half of the discussion, we really focused on identifying the issues, identifying the problem or problems, as you would have it, that are associated with men who are struggling with mental health. What we want to focus now in our second half is the solution. Now, our elder, Elder Bernard, earlier brought up the matter of self-control, and I think it is a very good point to pivot the second half of the discussion on. So we're going to be joining you now, Elder, to talk some more about that. What advice can you give? So this part of the program is going to be split into two parts. We're going to be focused on the solution as it relates to how do we cultivate self-control amongst our men as it relates to handling those stresses, those stressors, mental health concerns. And also, since we looked earlier at how we normalize, Sean, we looked at how we normalize men asking for help. We want to look now at how do we help men seek help. Right? So those are the two things that we're going to be focused on. Elder.
I have to go back again and then I come forward. I won't take long going back. I was baptized on the 21st of May, 1999. The day when I was getting baptized, a great war is the first time I ever experienced that develop inside of me. There was this feeling that I should not go in that pool, and there was this feeling that I should go. After baptism, great troubles come my way. And let me tell you this, if it wasn't for my stubbornness in sticking to the decision that I have made, I would not be here today. Meaning that I have chosen to join Christ. If you want peace in your life, you've got to join Christ first. The Bible says, seek ye first. And that's where my beating started in life. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And then, other things will be added unto you. I go the other direction and I get some bumps in life. But as I join Christ and my friends change, my circumstances start changing. Even the people who I used to work with, they stop giving me job because I become Adventist now. Me start get some new job from some new people. Little by little, change start happening around me. And peace that I never have start coming to me. New challenges arise. But because now I was walking with Christ, I now learn how to handle them. So therefore, the question is, how do you get peace? You must associate yourself with the right people. You must be a part of Christ. You must learn how to say no to that which is wrong. Set yourself a high spiritual and moral standard. That's key. If you go for anything, then anything. If you go for everything, then anything will happen to you. People must know you by the standard that you live. You must develop a sense of integrity that people respect you. Respect yourself. If you want peace, respect yourself. And don't let anybody tell you who you are. You must know who you are. Above all of that, the light of your character must shine forth. If you live in a world where you live in a cave, then who will see you? Who will know you? Who will trust you? Who will associate themselves with you? If you do not control your mind, you will not be able to have the ability to make good decisions. The decisions that you make is what either make or break you. The young people mostly have made not bad but wrong decisions because of inexperience. But as they grow older, and that's why I must forgive them and be patient with them, because as they grow older, they will make good decisions. Some of them learn by their mistakes, some never learn at all, some never make any mistakes, and so they blossom as they grow. Bottom line is this: if you are not a child of God, you are likely to run in problems. You must have peace because of the association that you keep. Without that, you got problems insurmountable.
Thank you so much, Elder. So seek first the kingdom of God, and peace will follow. Thank you so much. We're going to take the point from Robert, and then we're going to come to Elder Dockery for a follow-up. Gentlemen, the question is open to the panel as well, so I'll be coming to you shortly. Robert.
Right. I really admire the fact that we got that out of the way, like right off the bat, that, you know, that spiritual connection is something that we definitely need to have. I don't remember, Miguel, I think it was in 2015 or 2014 that we were in Mandeville, and we had a program for AY. We were discussing certain moral principles as it relates to even how young people socialize today. 2014. Now, there was this elder. Before we even started the program and they realized what the program, how it started, he got up and he pretty much said that, wow, he never saw the day that such discussions would be had in the Church of God. And how dare we come with this kind of program and whatnot. And as he said, self-control. So we said, with all due respect, Elder, we would advise that you sit, understand, and see where this is going, because we are going somewhere. When it got somewhere, midway the program, the very same elder got up and he said, he is happy. He is happy as it relates to the age at which he is now existing. Now, probably this man was probably like in his 60s, late 60s going on 70, right? Because when he realized where we're going with the program and how young people, the pressure that they themselves have to now deal with at their age as it relates to the moral compassing of their life, he is happy that he is heading out.
Just to assist early, the young people were asking questions in the program about sex. And you know, for the older folk, this is taboo, even the word.
Right.
So this idea of it being discussed openly, and the young people were, because we put out papers, and the young people sent in their questions, and they had a lot of questions. We were, all right. And we tried our best to respond to them. And just to echo what Early said, the elder said, boy, he's glad that, you know, it's not him. He doesn't have an answer for these things. Mm-hmm. And he really was grateful that we were there to assist.
Now, saying this to say, when our elder mentioned just now as it relates to having
that high level of spiritual and moral connection, I think we really and truly need to understand where this is coming from. Morality of the 80s, the 90s, changed. Like, yeah, pretty much I tell people, like, after leaving Cornwall at that certain time and went to college, like, something happened during that period. Because, you know, at times for those who attend university, it's like you're closed away from everything else that is happening. And when you actually step back out into the world, it's like, okay, what is this? So, of course, getting that culture shock now, leaving that little space and heading now into the working world and realizing now that I'm now teaching individuals who are like, okay, as a student, I never thought the way you thought. To the point of where, you know, as a student, if it's to the point of where if I'm even admiring a female teacher, it's just to me and me alone. But to the point of where now I have to be looking at young men and saying, careful how you look at your teacher, or careful what you're about to say, or careful how close you're moving towards the female individual. And the moral compass has pretty much been, can't find the words. Like, the compass, it's pretty much broken. Because it's like that level of magnitude has now strengthened so much to the point of where the compass can no longer work. It is free spinning. And what we have to understand is that in dealing with stress, especially with our young people, you see the things that they are doing. Hey, you see this thing called social media?
Yes. Let's go there. Let's go there.
This thing called social media. I don't. For some of you, you may think that, oh, it's just Facebook or WhatsApp and Snapchat. Check them out. Check them out.
Yeah.
It has gotten to the point of where these platforms are so public that persons are living their daily lives on them. To the point of where if they're going to commit suicide, they do it on the platform.
Yeah.
And this is now under the social media, these platforms that they are now, you have to realize now, these are the persons who are the new psychologists and therapists and counselors. Those platforms, they are now taking over that space because you have the audience and you can talk to them about your problems. They just go there. And whatever advice is it that you may get from there, they just give it to you and you roll with it.
Everybody is certified. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, you find the experts there. Mm. You understand? So, parents, or for guardians, whoever, you can actually relate to these young individuals, understand the level of pressure. Look here. I teach at an all boys school, so I really understand what I'm going.
Mm-hmm.
Seeing, I am looking at students on a daily basis who really and truly not feel well if they now wear a kickers. And you may look at it to the point of where they, no, you don't understand what I'm going. Them now go learn. Unless them are wearing kickers. That are the level of pressure.
Yeah, it's true.
You understand? If it's to the point of where, them here say, boy, because of course Cornwallians they tend to probably be mixed with girls from Mount Alverna or Moby High. If it's to the point of where them here say, boy, I want girl up listen and talk to them because stress. And he can't eat, he can't drink, he can't learn it. And guess what? He takes it to the social media page. And all of a sudden it's a big blast. When it comes down to the moral compasses, we have to really and truly understand that even from a spiritual aspect, Because remember, when you think about spirituality, you know, we're only looking at it from a Christian standpoint of positive spirituality.
Right.
You remember what we are fighting against.
Yep. Principalities and powers and
rules. Remember what we are fighting against. They meet these things on social media. They meet them. So when it comes down to the whole, as you alluded to before, the pill that works for you will not work for the other person. There are so many different avenues that we now have to navigate in order to understand how is it that we can help these individuals step out. You know, look here, there are things we could go further, but there are some things that I have to leave alone, because even with the whole aspect of sexual identity and all these different things that we tend to may want to run away from as a group, if you open your eyes, it's right here. Yep.
And these are just a few of the things that that pressure the minds of our young well, I want to say young people. Not to exclude our young females, but because the focus really is on the men today, I'm sure you will excuse us if I thank you. Right, you'll excuse us if I say the pressures that are you know on the minds of our young men. And if you're wondering why we're focusing so much now on the younger men, it's not that we're picking on anybody, but the truth is that it has to start somewhere. The molding has to start somewhere, right? As we mentioned before, and as has always been said, any kind of habit, any kind of mindset that you're trying to form, and when we spoke earlier about culturing certain behaviors, it has to start at an early age. It is harder to change behavior when you have been seasoned into it. Elder, I'm coming to you, so you can take your stand in the meantime if you still have your point. You may go to the mic. So on the matter of social media, no. So here's how we're tying that to what our elder mentioned earlier on the matter of self-control. It is important that our young people understand as well the dangers of social media, especially concerning the pressures that, you know, those factors that you mentioned earlier. It's very important that we understand this as young people, as young men. The pressures of life are not alleviated by taking it to social media, right? They're not. They're not alleviated by taking it to social media. The solution is not in social media either. I assure you, you are more likely to run into deeper problems, and it's more likely to do more harm than good. Yeah, it has been proven. I'm not here to bash social media because as a media specialist myself, social media does have its place in society. It does have its place in this world. It also has its place in ministry. But the problem is majority of our young people, majority of us who are using social media aren't using it for that particular purpose. And that's where the problem is. So on the matter of self-control, if you find yourself faced with these issues, if you find yourself faced with these challenges, perhaps the best place to be at that point is not necessarily social media. If you can, as a matter of fact, that might be the time to stay away. That might be the time to make a conscious decision to cleanse yourself, unless that decision is going to be taken because there are good places to be on social media. I could go on and on about certain pages that I could recommend for our young people to follow on social media because of the uplifting content that can be found on there, and that might be, I don't know if we have enough time for that this evening, but that could be, Lady AY Leader, that could be another AY program, just saying, you know. So we could look into that as well. Elder, we are coming to you now, sir.
Not a problem. There are so many points and so many issues, but certainly I will have to exclude some. But I just want to make the point that I think mention was made earlier on about the fact that some persons are labeled as being bali bali I want to acknowledge, I don't know whether you want to or not, but I want to acknowledge that by my judgment, some people are, in fact, bali. And all we simply mean by that, is that there are some people who are more emotionally responsive to stressors and to issues. We are not all the same, as I think the point has been made. The same pill will not work for everybody. And our threshold for stress differs. There are some issues which some of us, Brother Miguel, may be able to relate to comfortably, and we are all right. We can get over it and lead a normal life, while for others, it is absolutely devastating, and they need therapy, whether talk therapy or you need to take them aside and to pray over them, whatever it is. So we ought to establish that we are different. And I think a way, because you mentioned that one of the issues that we need to look at is how we proceed to deal with the problems. Yes, we must acknowledge that not everybody is the same. So because Elder Rahim doesn't cry and is not devastated because his lady who he loves so much has left him, if it happens to you and you are I can't say, go away, man. Look how Rahim, girl left him, and Rahim, all right. What? You understand? We cannot do that. We must appreciate each individual for who they are. And as brothers and sisters and members of the church, we ought to help to assist each other where they are to rise. So I quickly want to make the point as well that for me, the issue of self-control is definitely a biggie. As a matter of fact, whilst I had not spoken in the initial stages, Elder Bernard, as I listened to the conversation, that was the main issue. As a matter of fact, that is what has helped me. I remember as a youth, age 17 or so, I remember I sat for evenings after having gone to school and done my others, just the book, volume 2 of Mind, Character, and Personality. Books 1 and book 2, powerful. It speaks to the issues of the mind, the issues of who you are, how you control, how you survive, and the way that I have survived from that time until now, without getting myself in certain trouble, without getting messed up in a number of things, which so many of my colleagues, so many of my school colleagues, work colleagues, etc., over the years, and many other members in the church as my colleagues, the way how I have, by God's grace, I've been able to survive is through that basic issue, the issue of self-control. Mind control is a powerful thing. Man, as young people and as older ones too, you know, there are some, whilst we talk about the younger people, right, we can't leave out anybody. No. Do you know that many of the problems that we say today plague young people, plague older people? My research has shown even the issue of pornography, which we think is affecting many, there are many older people, older men and women who are slaves to pornography. Mercy. Yeah, serious thing. And the whole issue of the mental health issues and the struggles, many old people. So whilst you talk about correcting the young and so, there are some older ones whose souls are still valuable to God, and at this point they need help right now. Right? For their issues to be corrected and addressed. I don't know if it is that you wanted to say something, Ryan. I could cut and allow him to say and continue. All right. But let me tell you something. I have said that if it weren't for God, if it weren't for the Bible, if it weren't for the Spirit of Prophecy books, I think I would have gone crazy. I'd said that many, many times over the years. Because I have found, Paul said concerning Timothy, I think in 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 15, and that from a child thou hast known the Holy Scriptures, which is able to make thee wise unto salvation. I must say, many of the issues with which I have bombarded over the years, many stresses, many pressures, many issues which have confronted me to the extent that I felt like I was between the rock and the hard place, I was able to overcome and was able to control the mind because I had a foundation
in the Bible. The promises of God. I remember when I was at university the first time. Man, I can't tell you all the things I was going through. At night I had to go and sit down, man. And when I read through some of the promises of the Lord, many are the afflictions of the righteous, yes, but the Lord delivereth him out of them. Man, I was encouraged. My spirit was buoyed up, and that is how I was able to deal with it. How do I deal with issues, you had asked? So when there are stresses and things, I sit down and I try to process it. I pray. I process it, rehearse it in my mind, and try to come up with solutions. Now, in dealing and coming up with solutions, there are some things that happen. It don't make any sense your body to fight them. There are some battles. Just leave them. There is no, and move on. No need to fight those. There are others that it is important for you to relate to. And when I pray and talk to God, sometimes I don't get the answer immediately. But when I lie down or whatever, somehow I jump up at 3 a.m. with an answer. The Lord says, try this strategy. Mm-hmm. I tried it and over and over and over again.
It works.
And so I am saying that many of the issues that we have, yes, we may have formed bad habits. And when you do something over and over, you form bad habits. And you seem to be hedged in a box and can't get out. But God can help you to break those spells. I am saying the mind, it's all in the mind. It is powerful. It's hard to control. But just pray. Talk to God, seek his word, and also use meditation. Rehearse the good things that God has done for you. How he has done it in the past. How when you didn't have any money to pay your tuition, he worked out something. And you, man, and that will encourage you so that when the temptation and the stresses come upon you, by God's grace, you can be able, through control of the mind, to overcome those things and to move on successfully.
Praise the Lord. Thank you so much, Elder. And I really hope that my young men, especially in our audience and watching online, are not just taking these words as being cliche, because we hear them so often. And we might want to say that, you know, well, elders can say anything because they don't know exactly what. No, we're being real. You know, we're being real. But it happens. Let me just tell you, I know I said earlier that there's a different, the same pill won't work for everybody, but this pill you can consider a multi-symptom, right? This one works, right? So we're coming to you now, Sir Smith, and then we're going to come to you, Calvert.
Yeah, so I just want to make the point. I think Elder Docker really raised some very powerful points, as well as Elder Bernard. And I want to raise a very important point. I think one of the factors that we need to keep in consideration is that there's something that compromises self-control that is also a factor that leads to mental health challenges, and that is addictions.
Right,
and Elder Docker brought it up.
Thank you. Addictions
actually comes from a Latin word which means to be a slave. So when you have an addiction, you're actually a slave to whatever thing you have an addiction to.
Right, yes.
Now, let me just try to make something practical here in one moment. I think that as a church, where we come in, is that we have to be a safe space, yes, where people can actually find help to overcome their addictions.
Yes.
It's one thing to preach thou shalt not. And we need to preach the thou shalt not.
Yes.
But it's another thing to preach, if you have crossed this line, how do you get recovery? And I think that we need to have programs that are geared towards recovery.
Can I just ask you to say that again? Let me just ask you to say that again.
I'm saying that it's one thing to preach, thou shalt not.
Yes.
But it's another thing to preach that if you have crossed this line, mm-hmm, how you can actually achieve
Praise
recovery.
The Lord.
And I think we need to have practical programs, friends, that help people to recover self-control. Mm-hmm. Because here's the thing, if somebody is really struggling with an addiction, they cannot even appreciate spiritual things properly.
That's
right,
it.
Right.
Because the
right,
mind
that's it,
is compromised.
Right,
that's so it. Until we help that person to get free from that addiction,
yes,
then we will not have full access to the mind for God to communicate with them how he wants to. Yeah. So I'm saying that we need to have programs for people who are struggling with pornography, with masturbation, mm-hmm, with addictions to the cell phone or to media or whatever it is.
Yes.
We need to have programs that if you have this addiction, here are some steps that you can do to overcome. Here are some people that you can come and you'll speak to, and it will be confidential. The business will not go to anybody else, and they will help you to actually overcome. And friends, it might sound like a simple point, but as a church, if we are not the safe haven for this to take place, nowhere will be.
Yeah.
Amen. Yeah. Amen.
Nowhere will be.
Very, amen. Very, very, very good point. Thank you so much. And I'm happy that that is the way you brought your point across, because we were coming now to, you know, the matter of how do we help men to get help, right? So very, very good. Very good point, Bertram.
I truly believe that us young men of the panel here are connected, because I was here coming with a very well-planned and prepared speech of sitting here and listening, and this brother here got there before me. He mentioned the addiction and everything, and honestly, while we're on the point of self-control, I'm just going to say, man, like, as youngsters, as men, you have to be firm.
Yeah.
Can't shake it, so get left. And that's just it. Honestly, the self-control aspect of it, as the elder said, if you stand for nothing, you fall for everything.
Mm-hmm.
You have to have the self-control. And it is, I'm speaking about it now, and it sounds so simple, but it's easier said than done, right? We live in a generation where everyone has their opinion on what a man should be.
Mm-hmm.
Everyone has an opinion, as you mentioned before, everyone is an expert nowadays, mm-hmm. right?
Mm-hmm.
You have to stand for something. You have to know for yourself what you want to be, the idea of you that you have, you want to pursue, right? Look at it this way. You have a perception, right? You know what you want. No one will be able to sway you otherwise. If the foundation is set, you are the only one that can build upon it, because it's yours. No one else is there to corrupt that foundation, to break it down. Saying this to say that, as young men, we need to take accountability for whatever we do, whatever we are trying to achieve, and whatever plans we have to set in motion. Right? Because, as the elders said, they have the word, they have programs they read, they have things that they do that, you know, keep them grounded, keep them focused, guys. If you don't have something that you're working towards, if you don't have a focus, you're going out there, you're trying to just, you know, you don't have no clear direction, no clear path, you're just wandering everywhere, you will be lost. We don't need any more lost souls. You have to have your head on the body, have to be grounded, firmly rooted, right? And I'm trying to say, is that we as young men, we need a guide, and I'm thankful for the two elders that spoke. Because most young men don't have that guide, don't have that light, they don't know what to do. So, as I mentioned before, the church should be the place where if they don't have a father figure, they have someone they can look forward to, they can say, hey, this is how you should be as a man of God. This right. is the path that you should walk on, because if we don't have the elders to lay the path out for us, as mentioned before, we make a lot of mistakes as youngsters. And I don't even want to call them mistakes. I just say bad decisions, guys. You know, we need the guidance. So that's it. Thank you, elders, for speaking out. Truly appreciate it. And my fellow young men and brethren of church, keep grounded, keep focused, and keep moving.
Amen. 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 Thank you so much. Elder, I see your hand. I know you have a burning point. I want to find out first if there are any other points from my panelists before we take your hand, however. And then we are also watching the time. Now, I know the discussion is very interesting. We could go on for hours talking about, you know, how we deal with these issues. But I've been getting the wrap-up signal from our AOL leader for quite a while, and yes, she is stressing me out. Yeah, she's
want to bring you to tears.
as men of God, we must have order. So we'll follow the rules, and. We could have a part two. Right? All right. There's an agreement to that. All right. So I guess we'll be having a part two. Now, the psychologist, the budding psychologist on the panel, I want to hear from you as well. Remember, now we're still looking at how is it that we help our young men, especially, but you know, men in general. How do we help men to seek help?
Before you go, John, I just had another quick point I neglected to mention. With the self-control aspect, again, if this is not implemented as young men, it leads to other various adversities, such as our own insecurities and downfall, because we try to, men like to be in control. They like to see themselves as, you know, powerful, positive. And if you reach a point where your own words mean nothing to you, because you can't even, you know, follow up or go through with them, it tears you down. It slowly erodes at you. It eats you away, and then therefore you get to the point where you start to slump into depression. So that is the point that I neglected to mention.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much.
So before I go into ways that we can help men, I, at this point, actually, it's been a thought of mine for a good while now. For me personally, I have never been the type of person who listened to what other people say. It's always been, even sometimes get me into trouble, because I will, if you say something, I would rather, you know, you let's say my mother tell me not to do something, and I will take myself and go down that road and find out for myself and say, okay, she was right, and come back. But and sometimes that is very dangerous, because you might go down a road that you can't come back from.
That's right.
And it is, you know, for a person like that, like me, you have to really sit down and analyze. Okay, so this is something that probably is plaguing my mind. What is it going to do? What is going to come out of it? You know, how is it going to affect those around me? You know, what am I wanting to achieve? You know, sometimes, you know, you might be plagued with a certain addiction, and you know, I don't remember where I heard it, but I heard somewhere that, you know, when you're in addiction, your mind is clouded. Right. It covers your mind. And not just, you know, like drugs and those things, because those actually clog your mind. They actually clog up your system. Right. But the things that you watch, the things that you listen, your habits, all those things will form addictions, and you might have to, you know, you have to be able to take a step back and say, okay, so this is what I was doing. Do I need to turn around? Do I need to reach out for help? And I know not a lot of people are going to be able to do that, especially men. They're not going to be able to say, they're not going to want to sit down, and they're just going to continue until they reach a place where they, you know, they have to call out for help. But you have to be able to do that. To help men, I agree with the church being a safe place. Another example is, I lived with my grandmother for 2 years, grade 10 and 11, and I remember I had spent most of my life in Glenavon, so I had not really, even when I went to other churches, I hadn't really paid attention to those churches. And I remember I went to the Brownstone Estate. That's the church that my grandmother goes to, and it's like the atmosphere that was there was completely different than Glenavon. So I ended up, you know, I had my guard up, and I'm going to not, you know, do this and do that. I ended up, you know, being a lot more open than I was at Glendevon. Anything is on Glendevon.
You're but trying to fix it now. we see you trying to fix it. It's all right, go ahead.
Not anything is, but I had gone into the habit of, say, because everybody knows me, I'm going to come to church and I'm going to try to have this ear about me. Like, I'm going to have this, everybody always talks about, oh, Sean has so much potential and he can do this and do that. And I often tried to live up to it. I was able to find a safe place and, you know, just relax.
Yeah.
And that is what the church should be. The church should be a place where, as men, we're able to come and relax. Yes, there's things that the church has to uphold, but it should still be a place where everybody, not just men, but mostly men, as we're focusing on men, is a place to relax. Another way to help men is to, I'll draw on the point, because everybody else has already said it, but the woman in the men's life, is very important that you are able to support the men.
Yeah, that's the
word. Yes, because Oftentimes, nowadays, young men more likely listen to their peers than the women in their life, but there's still a special place for the women. Oftentimes has a special place in their hearts, and it has been proven that whenever their friends leave them, the women in their lives are right behind them. They're either their mother, their sister, somebody. So the woman, even when in the chastiser and he doesn't want to talk to you, you know, sometimes me and my mother don't see eye to eye, but she's still there. And it is important that, you know, you are there for the men. Because the men, even from a young age, there's a lot of pressure oftentimes put on boys to act a certain way, be a certain way, and, you know, by the time you reach this age, you're supposed to have this, and I in my mind, I feel like I hit a rut because I'm in university and I don't know where I'm heading after this. Okay, there are options, but I haven't made a decision as yet. So having that support from women is also important. I think that's all that come to my mind right now. Okay. If anything else, I'll say. But those are what I see as important.
All right. So we'll take. Thank you so much, Sean. If anything, we'll take the other suggestions in round two, in part two of the discussion. So as we wrap up, because we have to, we'll take one final point to add to Sean's point from. No, Elder, I remember you. No, I remember. I'm just talking about the part. Don't worry, we remember you. You know, but we don't want to be here until Sunday. But we remember you.
All right, so my point will be very quick. It's just as Sean said, like, women are very important to us men. All right, so women are very important to us men, right? As the saying goes, behind a strong man is an even stronger woman. So,
come on, sir.
It's like this. right? Honestly, I'm not going to hide it or sugarcoat it. And women generally cause us a lot of stress. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, you guys are very important to alleviating that stress as well. So if we reach a middle ground where the women and the men can say, hey, we work together, trust me, stress could possibly be a thing of the past. Because imagine, as one of the elders mentioned before, men need time to process and work things out. And, you know, women want to get to things right away, so, you know, they nag. But if you give us the time, I promise you that you will get the answer you want. Everything will be resolved. It just takes the time. So you will get your answer. Just be patient, and it will happen. So that's it.
It
You know, thank you so much, Mr. Calvert. You are a very brave man. You know? You're a very brave man. I hope to have you on the panel the next time.
Youthful exuberance.
But we do appreciate the honesty and the openness, and it is necessary. We did say that we want to have an open discussion this evening, and this is what we're getting. And I'm pretty sure it is helping you as well as it is helping the rest of us, because you're giving us hope. The rest of us who might have been a little bit timid to say certain things, you've given us hope, sir. Thank you so much. So, Elder, I'm gonna take you have changed your mind.
For part two.
All right, wonderful. Let me say thank you so much being. Oh, you had a.
Yeah.
All right. Is my namesake? I can't leave him out. One final point from Miguel, and then we close.
Oh yes, thank you. So, I just wanted to go back to the scripture of meditation, right? It's Matthew 11, 28 to 30. And this is Jesus speaking. He says, "Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest unto your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." At the beginning of every At the root of every mental disorder or spiritual problem, every spiritual is sin. Yeah. Okay? Yeah. And it is important for us to recognize this to begin with. I'm so glad that Elder Dockery would have used a word as strong as pornography. Mm-hmm. Well, everybody else was beating around and saying, what was the word? Self-control or whatever them some. He hit it really squarely.
Yeah.
The bottom line is though that these problems, as Ella pointed out as well, they are not restricted to any age group. All right, they are and any gender, as a matter of fact.
Right.
So this is important. Know that all of us have to be supportive of each other and to understand that our own efforts at struggling with these problems does not. In fact, it prepares us better to help the other person.
Yes.
Because we are more familiar with it and
yes,
it's relatable. Good? So when we can say, well, I have been a porn addict,
mm-hmm,
myself. I'm telling you straight up. Mm-hmm. I have been a porn addict. Mm-hmm. And how I overcame was through force feeding myself the gospel.
Yes.
Yeah, like literally. Because this is the sequence that used to happen.
You're replacing it.
Yes. It's a spiritual displacement.
Mm-hmm.
So you understand that your own carnal nature does not have anything to do with the gospel. You don't want to hear the Bible.
Mm-hmm.
You don't want to, what are you talking about? Everything is just there. Mm-hmm. Good? So what you really have to do is, well, what I did was force feed myself the gospel. That is to, you know, in the beginning stages, it was listening to audios of Ellen White books. Forcing myself to watch boring 3ABN. Just put it on 3ABN and don't take it off.
Right.
Just be bored. And after a while, there's nothing as sweet as the gospel.
Mm-hmm.
You say, wow. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. You just, and it's a process. It's a process, and you grow and you begin to share. But it's important. There's no solution. There's no amount of, there's no beautiful woman in the world that can insulate a man against pornography, addiction, or so on. There's no such person. So you have to understand that it has nothing to do with the woman, or she's not an advocate, or anything. It starts as a mental problem.
Mm-hmm.
It could be stress, and then you seek a solution here,
mm-hmm,
and then you gravitate, and then it becomes a spiritual problem,
mm-hmm,
because that's really where it is.
Right.
The solution is really spiritual, because no human agency can break that. It is the power of God alone that can break that. That's what I wanted to share.
So, thank you so much for giving us our Vesper thoughts, sir. Right. So that is a perfect note to close on, and that we will consider our Vesper thought. Thank you so much, Miguel. Thank you so much to the panelists for having joined us this evening as being a part of this very lively discussion. Thank you so much for to the persons who would have joined us online as well and would have participated in the discussion in the live chat as well. We have seen your comments. We appreciate your feedback as well. And we just hope that you have been blessed and inspired by the discussion this evening. We look forward to a part two. Thank you for our thank you to our live audience as well for staying with us. We still have a packed church at this hour. It's good to see that. Thank you so much for sticking around for the discussion. And you know, just please remember that mental health matters. There is nobody that is above mental health, but we still find the solution in the great physician. And so we continue to hold on to the great hope. We continue to hold on to his promises as being the solution to every problem that we might face. The discussion continues another time. Thank you so much for joining us. Until next time, let's stand together as we close with the hymn, Take My Life and Let It Be Consecrated, Lord, to Thee. That's hymn 330 in this Seventh-day Adventist hymnal. We will take verses 1 and the final verse, and then we will close with prayer.
Take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to Thee. Take my hands and let them move.
At the impulse?
At the impulse of Thy love. At the impulse of Thy love.
Take my love.
Take my love, my Lord, I pour at Thy feet its treasure.
Take myself.
Take myself, and I will be ever only all for Thee. Ever.
Smith to pray for us.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, that your Son Jesus identifies with us as males. We thank you, dear God, that he knows what it's like to be tempted. And yet, though he was tempted in all points like as we are, yet he was without sin. And so that afterward he's able to comfort us when we are tempted. Father, we pray in a special way for our men because the devil is after us. Dear God, there is a pandemic in our society of men being turned away from your purpose for them. Lord, we pray that through the power of Jesus Christ, us as your children, as your sons, will be transformed to be like Jesus. We pray that we'll be better husbands, better fathers, better sons, better leaders, whether in school, in the church, or in the society. We also pray for your daughters. We pray that you'll continue to bless them tremendously, dear Lord. We all have our challenges. We all have our stressors and our stresses. But we pray that we'll take those burdens and lay them at the feet of Jesus, and that we'll find healing for body, mind, soul, and spirit. We thank you, Lord, and we pray that you'll lead us through this week and help us to form habits that will prepare us for eternity with you, we ask, in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Lady Ava Leader.
Save your grief and evening's blessing. Every hope our spirit. Thank you.
Good night, everyone.